That's garbage. That's garbage. Hey, Andrew.
Oh, there we go. Oh, there we go.
No, we got, yeah, he's back on. All right, good.
Cool. All set?
I think so. There they go. They're going. They're leaving us. Andrew. I can hear you.
No, we're turning
it off and on because it's bright, and I don't like bright light. I'm a bat. Huh? Sure, yeah.
Are we loud?
Not to me. You can turn yourself down here.
Oh, really? Okay. Oh, there we go.
were you just screaming at yourself?
I was
time?
Like, yeah. I'm going to like.
Are we loud?
I'm going to.
Yeah.
Absolutely fry my eardrums.
Yeah, turn yourself down if you don't like it.
Oh, okay. I didn't even know that. I could do that.
There you go.
There we go. All right, cool.
I think this is left, right. One's louder than the other.
Gotcha.
But I think they're pretty well balanced right now.
Oh, this is the left ear, okay, this is the right ear?
Yeah. Left ear, right ear? No, I think it's the whole thing. Oh.
Okay.
Is which? Okay. Oh, yeah, okay. just you talking, just looping yourself.
Am I good with everything? You can hear me fine?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay.
Okay, and we're pretty well balanced. Sweet.
All right, cool. Thank you.
Yeah. What happened?
Perfect.
Oh, yeah. 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 Okay, so we're good. We're not going to be on. We're going to be on. The first time we're going to be on is at intermission, right? We were on camera twice during the intermission. And then on one off. Okay. So our analysis for the game is going to happen when we're not on camera, because the two times we're on camera, we're having people up here. But we're going to have time. So, yeah. Yeah, we have Hagwell and then Jeff Potter. Is what? Jeff Potter's the guy from the Orta.
Which side are they going to stand on?
Probably the same. Probably this side.
This side?
Yeah. Well, they'll be on this side. Why? Huh? Oh, for titles. Yeah. So I'm going to always be on this side. And then Topher is always going to be on this side. So we need Hagwell for here and Jeff Potter for here. Because you'll just be on the same side.
He's going to do Potter, right?
He's going to do Potter. I'm going to do Hagwell.
Got it. I have Potter on the...
Potter's on my side.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Potter's replacing me, and he's Hagwell's replacing him. Okay. Sure. Thank you. Jake Kiley and Glida. Yes. Yes, we know. Yes, do it. Yeah, we don't need them on. Yep, we're good.
In the event of emergency, you may be asked to contact Tonight's game is the ECAC Championship game between the Clarkson Golden Knights and the Cornell Big Red. Here are tonight's starting lineups, first for the Golden Knights of Clarkson University. Clarkson enters tonight's contest with a record of 25-10-2. They are the number 3 seed in the ECAC Hockey Tournament. On defense, number 13, Aaron Thole. On defense, number 3, Greg Morrow. At left wing, number 16, Jack Jacome. At right wing, number 18, Harold Eagle. At center, number 17, Nico Stern. The starting goaltender, number 29, Jake Kiley. Clarkson is coached by Casey Jones. He is assisted by Josh Helge and Brent Brecky. And now, the starters for the Cornell Big Red. Cornell enters tonight's contest with a record of 29-4. They are the number 2 seed in the ECAC Hockey Tournament. Starting on defense, number 8, Yanni Caldas. On defense, number 6, Alex Green. At left wing, number 14, Mitch Vanderland. At right wing, number 22, Jeff Malott. At center, number 10, Bo Starrett. And tonight's starting goaltender, number 35, Matthew Galita. Cornell is coached by Mike Schaefer. He's assisted by Ben Sear and Sean Flanagan. The officials for tonight's contest, referees C.J. Hannafin and Robert St. Lawrence, the linesmen Ryan Knapp and Dan Taggart. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise and remove your hats for the singing of the Canadian National Anthem being performed tonight by Mr. Brendan Gotho. And now please remain standing for the American National Anthem being performed tonight by Miss Emma Bishop.
Proof through the night.
Good evening, hockey fans, and welcome to the 2019 ECAC Hockey Championship game featuring the Cornell University Big Red and the Clarkson University Golden Knights. Perilous Garris here with Topher Scott here on ESPN Plus to bring all the action from Herb Brooks Arena. And Topher, we have an exciting one. Two teams who won pretty decently margin yesterday, but they're here for the title.
Yeah, absolutely. And these are two teams that are mirrored very much the same to each other. Again, Casey Jones is a former assistant coach of Mike Schaefer at Cornell. Brent Brecky, also a former assistant coach at Cornell. Both those guys are on Clarkson's bench, and both teams mirror each other pretty good. They're both very big. They're both very fast. They're both very physical, play a very defensive style. And
absolutely, and as they're...
Thank you.
Jumped on the moment
there.
Of silence there. You're right. No, we didn't want
to.
We wanted
so
to join
stop.
In there.
Yeah, yep. Moment of silence, so I had to stop. But yeah, both teams, again, they're very well coached. Both teams are very physical. They compete hard. And at the end of the day, once you get past all that, both teams have very good goaltenders in the net. So it's going to be a fun game here in Lake Placid tonight.
The Golden Knights come in with an overall record of 25-10-2. They went 13-7-2 in ECAC hockey play. The Golden Knights just ahead of them in the league. They went 13-5-4 in the league. 29-4 now overall after their win yesterday over Brown. And it was a convincing one. Maybe not as dramatic as the 6-0 scoreline would suggest. Brown did, you know, bring their all in that second, third period, but they weren't able to get past Matt Galita.
Cornell played a really good game last night. You know, they came out hard and fast. They obviously had a power play right at the beginning of the game where they were able to score two goals on that set the tone for it. And then the Clarkson-Harvard game was a fast, physical game as well. Two really good teams again playing with each other. And Jake Kiley had a great game. Jake Kiley had a great game tonight, and I'm sure he's going to carry that over into this big one here tonight as well.
Two of the better goalies in the country, both top 10 in the two big statistics that you look at for goaltenders, goals against average, save percentage. They're both right up there amongst the best in the nation, and that's what you expect from two teams who are playing for a title. If you're playing this weekend, you've had a lot go right for your season.
Sure, absolutely. And one of the things too is both teams play very well structurally, systematically in front of those two goalies. Both teams are big on defense, that can skate, play very well within their systems and their structure. But at the end of the day, sometimes you get through that, and when you do, then you got those two guys at the back of the net too. That's tough to get by. So goals might be a premium to come by tonight. You never know in these types of situations. Championship game, it packed here up in Lake Placid. It's going to be an exciting one. So as soon as the puck is dropped, you never know what can happen.
Clarkson wearing their green and gold uniforms. They wore the reverse yesterday. They primarily gold with the green trim and white trim, but it's the green uniforms tonight for Clarkson, and it's same unis for Cornell. They wore yesterday those white helmets, white uniforms, red pants, and red trimmings all the way around. Ready to drop the puck here in Lake Placid, ECAC Championship, the Whitelaw Cup on the line between those two teams. We're going to get a winner for the first time in at least 9 years here tonight. Cornell hasn't won since 2010, Clarkson since 2007. So it's been a while for both of these storied programs. As it'll be dumped in by Harold Ziegel, we're underway. Nico Stern behind the goal, works it back to the point at pass bounce towards Stowe. He's able to keep it alive for Eagle. Had a goal and assist last night against Harvard. Now up the wall comes Morrow. Greg Morrow twisting and turning. He'll find Jake Chacombe. And now Sturm again. Chacombe battles there with Green. It'll finally come free and moved out by Yanni Caldas. Caldas to center. He'll find Vanderlyn, who'll throw into the corner. Over to get it there is Thoe. He'll wrap it around to the near side. Chipped out center ice, Devin Rosso. Shot back in by Cornell. They'll get a chance to change.
Yeah, and Clarkson's already showing you why they're so good defensively. They had two guys below the goal, and as soon as they turned the puck over, what'd they have back? They had three guys back, not cheating the game. So Cornell couldn't get anything on transition.
Here is Josh Dunn kicking at it right in front of the Clarkson bench area. It'll be worked free by Chris Clack. A giveaway there. Noah Bald walking in. Centering feed and a tie-up at the last moment as Kyle Betts was trying to get his shot away. Brassard came in and he got his stick right in the right spot there to deny the shot.
Yeah, real good defensive play there by Brassard in Clarkson. And again, just goes to show you that these guys are really, really, really good offensively, and it's really tough to get through them through the middle of the ice.
Brendan Smith out of Centennial, Colorado, a senior. Got as far as neutral ice, but he's turned back to his own zone. That's what Clarkson was able to do to Harvard for much of that game, not let them out of their own end. Break to center. The Big Red finally do. Donaldson moves it in, but he gets stood up there by Hurley. It'll be wrapped around to the near side by Schneider. Shot comes in, redirected on goal. A good right pass saved by Kylie, his first of the night. Back comes Hurley, now 3-on-2 for Clarkson. Across, Yoki Hario, a shot, a blocker save made by Galida. Marley Quince battles a pair of Big Red behind the goal and kicks it away. Senior Quince from Sioux Lookout, Ontario, fed across, and a shot comes in, sticked away easily by Galida. Kept in by at the point by McCarthy. And now poked along. Joe Leahy scored his first collegiate goal yesterday in the 6-0 win over Brown. Flipped up. This is going to be icing here as Quince was not over the line. It'll send the draw back down. And that's a tired group. They're trying to get a change. The Golden Knights were there.
And here you see the chance. Great pass by Hurley over to Yoki Haryu. And what a nice save there. And Matt Galida sliding across to get it with his blocker. And again, one of the things that's really special about Matthew Galida is he makes tough saves look very easy. That's a tough save on a 3-on-2 rush to the trailer. He gets across real fast, reading the play, and was able to make the save. It makes it look a lot easier than it actually was.
Face off here. It's one of the freshmen for Cornell, Max Andreev, who's been the best face-off man statistically for Cornell this year. It's popped back out to center for Alex Green, fourth-round draft pick, the Tampa Bay Lightning in the most recent NHL draft. And it'll be chopped to center ice, but jumping right back on it is one of the big freshmen for Cornell, and Michael Rigish had a good league portion of his season. 9 goals of his 11 have come during ECAC hockey play. That one tipped to center ice through Campoli. Caldit on it. He'll chip it off the boards. Back for Alec McCray. And work it past Bo Sterrett into the Clarkson zone. McCarthy over to get it. They wave off the icing. McCarthy around behind. Goes by Kuzmeski. Chipped out to center by John Carter McClain, sophomore from Basking Ridge, New Jersey. Right back into the zone with her offside, and we get a stoppage. 16:36 to go, first period, no score.
And what you're seeing right now from both teams, a little bit of a feeling out process. Again, both teams like to come very aggressively on the forecheck. That's one of the strengths. They're big, they're fast, they're physical. So what you're seeing is a lot of rim pucks. They don't want to get their D hit right now. They don't want to make plays coming through the middle on the breakout because of such good structure on the forecheck. So they're taking chances by just getting it along the wall. So you're going to see a lot of wall battles here. That's going to be a big key to the game for both sets of wingers.
Face-off win for Cornell. Matt Nuttall going to shoot this one in. He'll be played around behind. Here's Vanderlyn trying to wrap around in front. Hits a skate. And then the shot and a save there. That was a lot. But Kylie had his right pad in the right spot, and that'll jump out of play. We get another stoppage here, but Jeff Ballot in the right place at the right time, just couldn't stuff it home.
Yeah, both goalies are certainly coming as advertised right now. Mitch Vanderlyn, number 14, the captain for Cornell, 95 career points coming into this game. Does a nice job taking the puck on the wraparound, puts it off Kylie's pads. Jeff Ballot is there for the rebound, but Kylie slides over and gets it with his right toe. Real good set of goaltending there by number 29, the assistant captain for the Clarkson Golden Knights net.
Milata Jr. scored the only goal for Clarkson 2 years ago in a 4-1 loss in the ECAC Hockey Championship game to Harvard. So he remembers playing here. He's been here now all three of his seasons here at Cornell. Chipped along up the boards. Here's Eagle. He'll jump on this puck in the corner. Leads the Golden Knights in scoring with 18 goals, including one yesterday. As it's going to be Kyle Betts to center. Tristan Mullen lost it for a moment. Now it's picked up by Brasso. ECAC Hockey Student Athlete of the Year is Brasso. A junior from St. Lambert, Quebec. And now a centering feed from Brasso. It was picked off and flipped to the point. Shot comes in, hit a skate. There's a shot by Dunn that goes wide off the glass. Pinching in McCarthy, but get to it first was Ball, but he can't clear the zone. And a puck played with a high stick will send the faceoff outside the zone. We're 4.5 in here. Pretty tightly contested game so far. Expecting a big crowd as well here.
Yeah, the crowd's, it's already filled in really well. Again, Clarkson only about 9 minutes away from Lake Placid. Cornell and Ithaca about 4 hours away, but you know Cornell is going to travel well everywhere that they go. So the atmosphere in Herb Brooks Arena is fantastic to start this one off.
It'll be done here on the draw up against Morgan Barron. the top scorer for the Big Red. And Dunn's going to win this battle and flip it in deep. Green over to get it. Alex Green takes a hit. And Clack comes away with it. Clack fanned on the pass back to the point. And Donaldson will break the other way. Gets as far as the red line before it's turned back around by Underwood. Caldas gets knocked down by Dunn. Thrown to the middle. He was trying to find Brasso, who was cutting to the middle of the slot, but it hopped off him back out to center.
You've seen a couple really big hits already from both teams. Again, both teams want to establish that physicality, which on the Olympic size sheet isn't very easy to do. But again, both these teams are big and they're fast and they're getting after it pretty good.
We got a hand pass here, so no change allowed. And still a feeling out period yesterday, but at this point we had a couple of goals. So I see Matt Nuttall there, top defensive D-man.
Yeah, and here you see Matt Nuttall going back to get the puck. You got Yoki Haru coming in, and that's a nice hit on the forecheck, getting up there on the best defensive defenseman in the ECAC this year. Again, the second year in a row that Cornell has had the best defensive defenseman, number 29, Alec McCray, winning it last year. Greg Morrow from Clarkson, also a finalist this year, so pretty good defensive lineup here in this game.
And, of course, the best defensive forward also in tonight's game in Nico Sturm.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
He's pretty good, too. You got to have some good players to get here. Puck goes to the side of the cage, in on goal from a tight angle. Galida is able to keep it out. It's lobbed back down. A race for the potential icing, and they wave it off. It just slowed up before the goal line extended. Now a quick outlet pass, two-line pass to Callen off the mark. McCray is going to work it off the wall, but right to Yoki Haru. He'll dump it in. Galida out to play. Picked up his fifth shutout of the year, did Galida yesterday. He's been red hot for this Cornell team. 5-1-1 in his last seven with a 142 goals against average. That'll win you a few hockey games. McCray backing up to his own zone. A hit thrown on Malott, but keep on coming. It's Sterrett. Throws into the middle of the ice. Swept away by John Carter McClay, but not out of the zone. Sterrett, a shot. And that one's blocked up into the netting. Getting in front of that was Tisdale. And we will step aside. 13:48 to go, first period. No score. Cornell and Clarkson in the ECAC hockey title game.
University, and it's really humbling being surrounded by so many like-minded people.
It's an institution with a lot of history.
Now I'm in this place where I know how to balance my life, and it's great.
Here there is such a focus on academics and athletics, and so you get to play at a really high level, but you also get to be in the classroom at a really high level.
It's been special to throw on this color every day. It's been something I'm very grateful for.
What makes Clarkson really special is
Clarkson is family.
Clarkson is home.
Clarkson is an opportunity.
Clarkson is pride.
Sorry, getting lost in my own eyes here.
The Clarkson education is top notch. Everything's really hands-on. Prepares me for life outside of hockey.
My hardest class I've ever taken would probably be econometrics.
Clarkson offers one of the best educations in the nation.
Last year, one goal short from a championship.
This year's gonna be different.
I'm Josh.
Jake.
Nico.
And I'm Golden.
And I'm a Golden Knight.
Face-off coming up here, Clarkson then. We've had some excitement already, but no score here. In the fifth ever meeting between these two teams in the ECAC Hockey Championship game. Cornell winning three of the four.
And these two teams have had a great rivalry, especially over the past decade or so. They've played each other in the playoffs quite a few times. A lot of big games, and this one means a lot to both programs.
That one just kept in at the blue line. Fans were hollering for an offside, didn't get it. Puck goes to the corner, Bo Sterrett on it. Senior from Bellingham, Massachusetts. And now Malott looking for the wrap in front. Sterrett, he was tied up by John Carter McClain. Now a shot to flex over the top of the net. And Sterrett was tied up in front, providing a screen. Tipped out to center ice by the Golden Knights. Nick Campoli now dumped right back in. So takes a hit, lost the puck, but gets some help from Campoli, who picked up a tally yesterday. His fifth of the year, it's shot in. Jacome throws it right on through, caroms around to the point. McCarthy sends it below the goal line, looking for Eagle, but it's broken up nicely by Green. He'll lift it off the boards, out to center ice. where it's blocked down and corralled by Jack Jacome again. Jacome for Kuzmeski. Long saucer pass across the ice. And now Sturm with some speed into the zone, trying to make a move. Popped off his stick by Kallis. He gets taken out. Now it's a two-on-one. It's Bald with Locke. Back to Bald. He scores! It's 1-0 Clarkson.
What a play by... 1-0 Cornell. Great play by Noah Bald and Brendan Locke. And it all started with Alec McRae at the blue line, the defensive blue line, holding up with Nico Sturm, one of the top players in the country. And here you see Noah Bald right back from Brendan Locke and puts it in. Noah Bald, again, not a goal all year until the playoffs against Union. Now he's got a bunch of points in the last couple games in the playoffs. Call him Danny Briere of the Cornell right now, coming up big with another goal in the playoffs. Great job by Noah Bald.
Yeah, Bald, 3 goals, 4 now. And Cornell with the 1-0 lead. That's, you're absolutely right. Topher, 1-0 to the team in red and white. Now it'll be fed across by Dunn. And that's going to be tough. It's going to be tough to beat Kylie tonight, but if you have a 2-1 like that, it's tough for any goalie to stop that kind of one-timer from that close to the net.
Yeah, you should see great skill by right there by Noah Bald and by Brendan Locke. That little tic-tac-toe give-and-go play.
Now Barron turns and shoots one over the top. It'll be corralled there and shot on behind. Keeley had to swat it away. And now Brasso can't get it out of the zone. Kept in by Andreev.
And
corralled by Clack for a moment, but Andreev back on it.
Assisting on the goal, number 28.
Now Nuttall shoots it in deep. Greg Morrow to play. Kept in by Nuttall once more. Morrow tries to clear it out. Hits off of Quince, but goes right to Rigish. Here is Michael Rigish. Trying to throw it out in front, but Morrow broke it up well. Now he's double teamed by a pair of big red behind the goal. Now gathered up and moved out by Quince. Here's Liam Motley, didn't play yesterday. He's back in the lineup. Works it up the wall. Now Quince once more for Clarkson. And that one wraps up a stick and goes up out of play. 11:03 to go first period. Cornell on the board first here. The play that started in the neutral zone, it was a good break up and it quickly turned into a 2-on-1 the other way.
Yeah, both these teams, again, a lot of their offense comes in transition from being really good defensively. And Alec McRae made a great play standing Nico Sturm up at the blue line to kind of force that turnover to get Noah Bald and Brendan Locke going the other way. So again, great play by the top defensive defenseman from last year's campaign, Alec McRae, and ends up in a 1-0 score here for Cornell.
Faceoff coming here. Cornell territory. Cornell does a lot of scoring first, and we see it again here this evening. How Clarkson responds is the first question at hand. McLean will go across. Finding Thoe. Thoe will dump it in. It'll wrap around for Sterrett. Letting it run Nuttall, and now Leahy. Malott off the board looking for Vanderlyn, but he's cut off by McLean. Now Tisdale fires this one in, and Clarkson wants to finish off the change. Leahy to pick it up here. Back for Nuttall, senior from Delwood, Minnesota. Officially the game-winning goal against Brown. Of course, Cornell only needed one of those 6 in the end. But they had to start somewhere. McCarthy, Sturm. One hand pass, middle of the ice for Eagle, now backing up and sending it up ice is Kuzmeski. Galida going to wrap this one around. Eagle throws a hit. It'll be just backhanded to the middle of the ice. Greenhant there, but gave it right back to Eagle. Eagle makes a move, gets spun to the ice. Fans looking for a call, not going to get it here. Pitching in now on the far side is the Clarkson defenseman over there, that's Underwood. Back to the point. Sturm, Schneider. Was a +3 yesterday and scored a goal against Harvard. Underwood again. Wrist shot, looking for a redirect that never came. And hops right back out to center ice where Schneider has it again.
Good shift there by the top line from Clarkson. Nico Sturm, Harold Egel, and Jack Jacome getting a lot of offensive zone pressure time, keeping pucks in by Schneider and Underwood at the point. So that's what you want to see Clarkson do if you're a Clarkson fan, is get a lot of ozone pressure, play a lot below the goal line of Cornell Big Red, and try to get pucks to the net, keep it on the inside.
And now we get our first penalty. It's going to be a hook. We'll tell you all about it. We come back, 9:03 to go, first period. 1-0 Cornell in the ECAC Hockey Championship game. McRae in the box for a hook, and Clarkson almost capitalizes immediately off the draw as Brasso looking for the tap in at far post. Didn't happen. Dunn down low for Brasso. Back up top, Kuzmeski. McCarthy has a shot. He fired it through a screen. Galita shaking his head as he blockered it away. He was in good position. Kuzmeski at the point. Off wall for Brasso. Nuttall had him bottled up. Still fights for it there. Get some help, but it's cleared all the way down by Sterrett.
Nice read by the best defensive defenseman in the ECAC, Matt Nuttall, right there. But right off that faceoff, Josh Dunn, a sneaky little play going forward off the draw. And one of Michaelida's biggest strengths is his hockey sense. Using his stick to poke that pass away. Unbelievable play by the goaltender for Cornell.
To the corner it goes from Malott. He can't clear as Dunn got there to break things up, but Malott back on it here. Junior from Burlington, Ontario, clears it as far as center. It's broken up by McCarthy. He wants to walk back in. His shot was blocked down by the skate of Caldas. Now Josh Dunn, 14 goals and 7 assists in his freshman campaign. Thoe, McCarthy, 52 to go on the power play. Brasso back to Thoe, looking for a lane. Back up top, Brasso steps into one. It tipped over the top of the net. Malott cleared it off the referee on the far side. That's Hannafin, C.J. Hannafin. And Robert St. Lawrence, the two referees for this title match. Down low, Dunn. Back up top, Brasso. Brasso, a shot, he scores!
What a shot by Devin Brasso, the student athlete of the year for the ECAC. Tough luck there for Cornell. Jeff Malott got the puck behind the net, tried to clear it, hit off the ref. C.J. Hannafin right to the Clarkson player, and as we'll see on the replay, nice little puck movement there by Josh Dunn and Devin Brasso. Alex Green just couldn't get his stick on it, and Brasso fires it right underneath the glove of McElida to tie this one up at one.
Quite a rip, but when you're between the dots like that, it's tough for a goaltender to react. You're kind of trying to be in the right spot there.
Yeah, and again, you got to give credit to the shooter there. Brasso wired right underneath his glove. But again, Clarkson, real good puck movement right there. They're trying to change lanes. They're trying to switch around guys and kind of scissors up top to try and change shot lanes and get Cornell out of their structure, which they are so good at. Again, Cornell, one of the top penalty kills in the country. So very good execution there by the Clarkson Golden Knights on their power play.
13th goal of the year for Devin Brasso, his 7th on the power play. That leads Clarkson in that department. And so he looks for those type situations to get on the score sheet, and he does here to tie things at one. Nuttall, watched by Quince, takes a hit. Leahy trying to work it up the wall. Now breaking to center is Locke. On for Nuttall, some room to work on the near side. Nuttall pulls it back, takes the shot. A glove saved by Kylie. He'll hold on for the whistle.
Nice breakout there by Cornell. Matt Nuttall joining the play on that second wave. That's something that you want to see from your defenseman in this day and age, the way that hockey is played, again, it's very, very hard to score, specifically against these teams that are very good structurally. So a great job by Matt Nuttall getting up the ice, and a nice little pull-in shot, a great save by Jake Kiley through the screen.
Draw coming up here. Sturm up against Betts. Both over 55% in the faceoff. Donald, though, Betts is getting tossed for Mullen here. And in a clean win back for Nico Sturm. 1-1 the score. Snyder to center, finding Sturm. Try to drop it back. Betts breaks it up. Now McRae behind the goal. Again. Referee on the far side getting involved, and Jacoma play it behind, looking for Eagle. Takes a shove from McRae. Harold's Eagle from Liepāja, Latvia. Back to the point, looking for the deflection from Sturm. And the try by Underwood doesn't come. And they moved on out to center ice. Chris Clack back to play. Let's it run for Schneider. 6.5 to go, first period. Cornell scored first. Clarkson has answered here on the power play. The only penalty this game has been converted into a goal. Brasso in corner, wrapped up there. Puck comes loose to the point. Clack just tries to fire it right back in. Now Kuzmeski has a man in the middle. It was done, couldn't find him. It'll be gathered up by Rigish. Rigish cross ice, find. It's Andreev. Pulls up at the hash marks. Andreev drops it off for Kaldas just off the bench. Kaldas walking in, and his centering pass was broken up. McCarthy going to move it on out towards center ice.
Nice defensive play there by Clarkson, getting the puck again. Yanni called, second team all ECAC, bringing it around for Max Andreev. Nice little break up there right in front of the net.
Now another steal just across the line to stay onside. Vanderlyn pressured by Quince, looking to feed it through, nearly found Nuttall. Now it's shot out of play. And we will step aside here. 5:32 to go in the first period. 1-1 Clarkson and Cornell here on ESPN. Back here live at Herb Brooks Arena, ECAC Hockey Championship game. Second seed Cornell versus third seed Clarkson. Perilous Garris and Topher Scott up top here.
Yeah, great start to this game, Perry. Very fast, very physical, very structured, but both teams have had some pretty good scoring chances on two of the best goalies in the country as well.
Find ourselves at 1-1. Here's Donaldson, left in the corner for Locke. Brendan Locke, a sophomore out of Iroquois Falls, Ontario, hands it off for Leahy. Scored on a wraparound goal yesterday, and this time he flips it out in front. Nothing comes of that. Pops back point for Nuttall. He fires one that finds its way all the way through to the stick of Kiley. And now Foe shoots it off the boards.
We're seeing Cornell's defense get really active in the offensive zone. Clarkson's forwards are really good at fronting up top, really good at getting shot lanes and blocking shots. So Cornell activating their D, trying to get them outside their comfort zone.
Quinn's going to dump this one in. Smith takes a look. Colton's changing, so he has plenty of time. It'll be Brendan Smith to center ice, former Omaha Lancer. Chipped in deep by him a lot. Stair trying to get there and does. A little tap pass off for Vanderlyn. Spins away from the check of Campoli. Into the crease it goes, and trickles on out the other side. Now Malott, wrapped up there by Underwood. Sterrett comes away with it now. He'll take a shot. Vanderlyn trying to lift it over. Now a wraparound try, getting his toe to the post. Was Kylie quickly right to left to make the stop. Still on the attack, Cornell, though it comes free to Tisdale. He'll stick candle to center and dump it in.
Great save by Jake Kylie again, showing why he's one of the best goaltenders in the country and up for the Mike Richter Award. He has been phenomenal tonight to start.
And Sturm gets bumped from behind, and I don't think he or Malott knew of the other's presence, and this is going to be a tough penalty to take for somebody. I think it's Malott.
Yeah, it looked like an accidental play right there. Jeff Malott was skating forwards. Nico Sturm was kind of drifting backwards. Looks like both guys are hurt right now. We'll see it on the replay as it comes through. Nico Sturm just kind of skating backwards. Jeff Malott almost looked like he was trying to get out of the way of Nico Sturm, but they collide accidentally, and it'll be interesting to see what the refs call for a penalty. I think they're going to have a penalty on Jeff Malott.
Only for the fact that I guess he was going forward, but you're right, it looked like he was trying to move out of the way. I don't think he saw Sturm right away, who was kind of backing up to get into shooting position. He was looking for a pass, and he didn't see Malott. Hopefully they're both all right. Remember, Malott was the one who was hit from behind by Berger of Brown last night and sent Berger to the showers, and then Malott took a five-minute major later in the game in that second period.
Yeah, and Jeff Malott's been a big piece of this Cornell team. Very good player, big, fast, physical on the forecheck. He has had some injury troubles this year, so you're hoping to see he's all right. Ed Kelly, the trainer for Cornell, out there tending to him right now as the two captains from Cornell and Clarkson are talking to the refs to try and sort out what's going to happen in terms of penalties.
Looks like Malott getting back to his feet. I want to go back to those four previous meetings and championship games. First met 1966, the lone Clarkson win 6-2. Then in 1971, a name that some hockey fans in the area will know, Ned Harkness took Cornell to the league title in 1971, 3-2. 1986, Cornell shut out Clarkson, the only shutout. We won't have one tonight, obviously, 3-0. And then 1997 was Coach Schaefer's win over Clarkson, 2-1.
Yeah, this has been a fantastic rivalry dating back a long, long, long time. Even the national championship game when Cornell beat Clarkson in 1970, one that was Cornell's only undefeated season and the only undefeated season ever in NCAA hockey. And but Clarkson, I'll tell you what, Casey Jones, he's the ECAC Coach of the Year for a reason. What he's done with this program over the past couple years especially, again, they got here, they were one goal away from winning the ECAC Championship last year. They're back in the ECAC Championship this year, so great job by Casey Jones and his staff to elevate Clarkson to where they are right now.
Yeah, Casey Jones in his eighth year, as Topher mentioned, winning the Coaching Staff of the Year, Coach of the Year Award here in ECAC Hockey. 3:54 to go in the first period as we're back to action here. There is a penalty on Malott for interference. And McCarthy's going to play here. Brasso back to McCarthy. And now Kuzmeski. Clarkson 1-for-1 on the power play. Devin Brasso picking up the tally. Trying to take his first lead down low. Dunn, a spin move, tried to stuff it in. It was poked away. Now Dunn again. Left in the corner for McCarthy. The defenseman will play it up to the point for Brasso. Kuzmeski. Over to Dunn. Josh Dunn across for McCarthy, walking in. Far side, one-timer, they score. It's Brasso again, his second of the game.
What a great play by the Clarkson Golden Knights on that power play. Again, they get Cornell a little bit overextended. Kyle Betts a little bit out of position right there, trying to get over to the far side. And what a nice pass to thread the needle across to Devin Brasso. And a great finish on the side of the net. As we see, Connor McCarthy, the big 6'7" defenseman, as the two Cornell defenders are trying to get back with their sticks in the passing lanes. But that's a big time goal by Brasso. That's a tough shot from that angle to get it in on Matt Galita right there. So Brasso stepping up big time for his team coming into this first period.
Brasso's 14th of the season.
And I'll tell you what, interesting, Casey Jones, after each timeout, didn't put out his top power play unit. He put out the power play unit with Devin Brasso. They've scored both times that they've been out there, so credit to Casey Jones for kind of seeing who's hot and letting them go with it.
So now Clarkson has its first lead with 3:15 to play in the first period. Shots are 9-7 Cornell, but they find themselves down here for the first time this weekend. McCray sent up Bice, tipped in by Mullen for Betts. Good poke check there by Sturm. He'll wrap it near side, past Jacome. And McCray will play it off. Tristan Mullen shoots it in. Morrow back to pick it up. Junior out of Edmonton, Alberta. We'll wrap it up the far side now. Here's Jacome, one-on-one. Drops it off. Sturm, a shot that's blocked down nicely by Caldas. Stolen back, however. Jacome trying to get away from Caldas. Lost an edge and went down. Now Eagle. He goes down, and they're going to call another penalty here on the Big Red. It's going to be a trip. And a third power play coming for Clarkson right here.
Yeah, Coach Schaefer not too happy on the Cornell bench right now, looking up at the board to see the replay. Alex Green got his stick in between the legs of Harold Zegel as he was trying to get the puck around in front of the net. And here you go, Clarkson's second unit back. I shouldn't even call them their second unit, Clarkson's other unit back on the ice. Here we'll see on the replay. Harold Zegel gets the puck as he tries to muscle his way through the net. Alex Green has a stick in between his legs. Not sure if that's what he tripped on or not, but enough for the refs to call it a penalty. And here we go, Clarkson, another power play opportunity.
Two for two. Here's a blast blocked down by Barron, and out to center it goes. Barron trying to will his way around and could not do so. Got some help, did Kuzmeski. And now Kuzmeski's stick handles the other way. Brasso working on a natural power play hat trick right now. Has the puck at the point. Kuzmeski across here for Dunn. Just a 27 or so sec difference in the power play clock and the game clock here in this first period. Brasso down low for Dunn again. And Dunn will slow things down. McCarthy up top. Kuzmeski for Dunn once more. Brasso in the same spot he scored earlier, down along the goal line. They find him in the middle. That was Kellen. Could not be cleared. Oh, it does. Skips by Kuzmeski out to center. Cornell will change one of its penalty killers halfway through this one. Dunn flips it deep. McCray gets there. Has time. Elects to play it off for Smith. And now Betts is going to clear it out to center ice.
Yeah, good job there by Cornell. And again, another real good movement power play for Clarkson. You see Josh Dunn and Devin Brousseau switching spots and switching with each other as they're going around on that far side. But a good job by Cornell to kind of recognize that and take away the middle of the ice.
Cornell's penalty kill, 87.4% coming into this game. That's fifth in the country. They've given up two goals and two opportunities to the Golden Knights here. Jacome shot through traffic, Elida. And a man in front, that was Sturm, he's able to see it in the hole.
Yeah, and Cornell's penalty kill, typically a huge strength of theirs throughout the entire season. At one point, they had over 30 penalty kills in a row just in the last month. So again, uncharacteristic of Cornell to give up two power play goals, specifically in the first period. So that's something they're going to have to clean up and make some adjustments coming into the intermission.
21 seconds to go on the power play. A little over 48 seconds in the period. Thoe off the offensive faceoff win. Morrow back to Thoe. Thoe pulls it back, thought about a shot, finds Eagle. Eagle lifts it for Jacome, back to Eagle. Throws it in front, knocked out of there nicely and moved out by Barron. That was a good read. Out of the box now is, Green. Took that tripping call. Now a shot out of play. We got another stoppage here, 18.7. So Cornell kills off the third penalty. They're now one for three killing them off, or one for three killing those penalties.
Yeah, again, and we talked about this yesterday throughout both games. So hard to score in the ECAC, so hard to score in the playoff. Therefore, in the ECAC playoffs, really, really hard to score. So you got to get goals. Special teams is such an important part of the game. Again, Cornell scoring three power play goals yesterday to lead past Brown. Here, Clarkson gets two right away in the first period against Cornell. So special teams in the second and third period going to continue to play a big part of the game.
Important face-off here. If Cornell can win, maybe they can get a shot away. Here's McCray. Fed off the end wall. Corralled there by Locke. Little handoff play. McCray shot it. Popped up in the air. Dunn's going to gather. Six to go in the period. Callum moves past him. Cornell will corral. And that will do it here for period number one. Cornell scored first. The Golden Knights answer with a pair of power play goals by Devin Brasso to take a 2-1 lead.
Great period. Great period here in Lake Placid. Very fast, very hard, very physical.
again, once it got into the special teams type game, Clarkson, they capitalized on their opportunities. Jake Kiley was there when they needed him, so really good period by Clarkson going into the second period. Should be an exciting one. Big 40 minutes coming up.
All right, we're going to step aside here in our first intermission. Clarkson on top of Cornell, 2-1 after one. You're watching the ECAC Hockey Championship game on ESPN. Hey everybody, back here live at Herb Brooks Arena, Perilous Garris and the ECAC Hockey Commissioner, Steve Hagwell. And Steve, thanks so much for coming on here between periods.
Thanks for having me, Perry.
Steve, obviously a big part of the year, maybe the biggest part of the year, is this these three games here up in Lake Placid. Overall thoughts, you got a couple of great games here as of late, including this championship game so far.
Yeah, it's been a great tournament so far. This is the staff, this is what we strive for all year on the men's and women's side, to get to this point where, culminates in crowning a league champion. And here in the great village of Lake Placid, where it was snowing today, the magic continues. It's a great crowd here this evening. I'm looking forward to the final number, and we got a great game going as well.
Absolutely. I remember it was about 20 degrees colder last time I was up here. Minus 10, I wanted to stay indoors, but now I don't mind walking around. Yeah.
No.
What's so nice about this area? I know that the tournament's been in different areas.
It's going to sound a bit corny.
Yeah.
But given the history of this with the Olympics and the game and the gold medal, and it's just kind of a magical place. I mean, it may sound corny, but it really is. And when it was snowing today, I was thinking, oh gosh, don't give us the 15 inches that they were forecasting, because we want people at the game. And it's just walking the village, you see jerseys from other teams that even they're not here.
Yeah.
And it's just a hockey town, and has a lot going for it. We spent time, my wife and kids, and just tooling around town, walking around, and it's just a great atmosphere.
Hey, I don't find it corny, so
okay.
You keep that, whatever that's worth to you.
Yeah.
ECAC hockey, looks like four teams going to the NCAA tournament.
Yes.
That's a pretty big accomplishment for any league, you know, especially for this one, which had some success in the tournament as of late.
Yeah, first time since the break with Hockey East in 84-85. So we're looking forward to the tournament, and hopefully one team, there can be only one, will raise the national championship trophy at the end of the year. But people ask me about the league every year, and I say it's tight and so on. I think it's crazier every year. We had five teams going into the final weekend that could have all shared the regular season title. And on the final night, it was four.
Yeah.
And so there's two staff members, and we're trying to figure out where we're going.
Yeah.
And you can only be in two places with two people. So it worked out, though.
I have to ask you about on the women's side, both of the ECAC hockey teams yesterday were knocked out here in the Frozen Four down at Quinnipiac. Has to be, Clarkson, they can't win every year, it seems like. So still a good showing for the league down there.
Yes, I was hoping we could win every year. But yeah. And then Lauren Gable getting the Kazmaier Trophy today was tremendous. So, you know, advancing to the Frozen Four is very, very difficult, and once you get there, you got to get there to play for the national championship. Unfortunately, this year, our teams didn't do it.
Speaking of 1984-85, I'm sure there's some fans from another school that hope things come back to the 1984-85 season.
Yeah,
anyway, Steve. This season's been great. You talked about how close it was down to the end. What has been like for you, just seeing from afar? You know, everybody, even Brown, was kind of played this year's Princeton in this year's tournament, making that run and really showing that it doesn't matter who you are, you have a shot to get to
exactly.
the Classic.
And every time I think I got to figure it out, I don't know anything. So that's how it worked out this year as well. So
awesome. Well, Steve, thanks so much for joining us here. We'll send it back to break here with the Clarkson on top of Cornell, 2-1. You're watching ECAC Hockey Championships on ESPN.
White passes, it's easy, hold this back.
Live here at Herb Brooks Arena, between periods, 1 and 2, Perilous Garris, Topher Scott, and overall thoughts on that period. A little bit reminiscent of yesterday, the power play is really playing a huge role.
Yeah, power plays for Clarkson and penalty kills for Cornell. Again, three power plays for Clarkson. They go 2 for 3. Devin Brousseau, two goals, really nice goals as well. Clarkson really moving it around on the power play really, really well. And again, Jake Kiley has been called upon a couple different times and made some pretty big saves too. So this was a game that we knew was going to be exciting. There's a lot of people here. The crowd is buzzing right now. And they're getting a big heavyweight tilt with these two clubs. And I can expect that the next 40 minutes is going to bring a lot of the same.
Josh Dunn picking up assists on both Clarkson goals. The Cornell goal we spoke about. Noah Ball scoring his third goal in 4 games after not scoring all season from Brendan Locke and Yanni Kellis. So, you know, we don't feel like this is going to be the final score 2-1 the way these teams played that first period.
Yeah, it's something that almost you would expect from both teams. Again, both teams very, very good defensively. Again, Cornell's first goal, I apologize. I actually said it was Alec McCrea that stood the kid up at the blue line, but it was Tristan Mullen, number 26, the forward, that stood him up after watching the replay again. And both teams, again, very good structurally, very sound. They work hard both ways and play 200-feet games. So, again, nothing would surprise me when it comes to goals against with either of these two teams. But, again, you're probably going to see Cornell come out, press a little bit more, involve their D in the rush a little bit more as well. You've seen their D be active in the offensive zone. At the end of the day, they got to stay out of the box. Clarkson's power play has shown right now that it can buzz it around, and that's going to be a big key going through the rest of the game.
The peripheral stats are pretty tight. Cornell outshot the Golden Knights 9-8. Faceoffs were 10-8. Clarkson, including Josh Dunn, went 5-0 in the draw. Nico Storm 4-2. Their big drum in there, doing a great job in that first period. Are faceoffs even more important when you have the wider sheet, because you can really work into some kind of action off the draw?
Yeah,
seemingly.
Faceoffs are important. I think at this time of year, especially, like we talked about yesterday, again, the first goal that was scored in the Harvard-Clarkson game right off a faceoff. And again, faceoffs equal possession. When you can get offensive zone possession, especially on the Olympic sheet, where you can get guys going a little bit more with a lot more movement, absolutely, it can be a big part of gaining some offense and creating chances in front of the net.
So we will we'll stick right here as we prepare for period number 2. And the two power play goals for Devin Brousseau, he's the ECAC Hockey Student Athlete of the Year. And that's an important word for an important award in a conference that's known for academics. Obviously, the Ivy Leagues are a huge part of that. But, you know, RPI, Clarkson, St. Lawrence, these are all their school, Colgate, they're all big-time academic programs. So to win an award like that feels like it means a little bit more in this conference.
Yeah, well, student is first for a reason. And the kids that are coming through these schools, yes, they're getting a great hockey experience, but they're also getting themselves a great education, which can set them up for the rest of their lives. And Devin Brousseau, give him a lot of credit for what he's done as a hockey player here at Clarkson. He's been a staple in their lineup for the past 3 years. Lost his buddy Sheldon Rempel, who went to sign professionally last year. They played junior hockey together in Nanaimo in the BC Hockey League, but he's picked up right where he left off those past couple years on the hockey rink, and great to see him win an academic award as well.
Absolutely. That was a terrorizing line when it was Sturm, Rempel, and Brousseau together all at once, and I'm sure the rest of the ECAC hockey is glad to see Rempel go. He's off playing with the Kings out in the NHL. So yeah, it's interesting. That's kind of where college hockey has gone. You're having more guys that leave after a year or two to go and try to play professionally, but that's because it's got a lot more street cred, a lot more cred to the college hockey game. More guys are going that route.
Yeah, every year in pro hockey, and specifically the NHL, more and more people are coming from college hockey. I think the college development path, where you're not playing as many games, getting a little bit more time in the weight room, doing off-ice activities, and then the maturity side of it. You know, college hockey is a little bit older than junior hockey is, and guys are going into pro hockey a little bit older, a little bit more mature, so they're ready to handle, you know, the grind that is professional hockey, because it's not an easy living to make.
Absolutely not, and you see it also really starts from the top down as far as these NHL teams making a concerted effort to go after college guys in the draft.
Yeah, and again, I think, you know, the junior leagues that are not major junior are doing a really good job of developing talent just as well as the college teams are. So you're seeing a lot more kids even coming into college hockey drafted. And
And it's a great league to get going on your college career. It's a great league to get going for your professional career when you do get up the levels. So again, great job by all college hockey and junior hockey developing these athletes to play at the highest level.
All right, well, we're ready to start the second period. 2-1, Clarkson on top of Cornell in the ECAC Hockey Championship game. Perry Lascaris and Cooper Scott here. High above 1980 rink at Herb Brooks Arena. We'll have 5-on-5 hockey to start this second period, and some more ice maintenance. A couple of linesmen, Ryan Knapp and Dan Taggart over there to help out, try and fill in a hole, looks like. And so that'll give Bo Sterrett and Nico Sturma a chance to talk about what's going on in their respective classes going on at the end of the year, I'm sure.
I don't know if they're talking to each other very nicely, but it's interesting to see the Bo Sterrett line start against Nico Sturm, because typically Coach Schaefer has used their, we'll call them the grind line right now, with Kyle Betts and Noah Bald and Tristan Mullen against those guys, try and physically frustrate them, try and get them off their game a little bit. Because again, that line, you know, Nico Sturm is a Hobey Baker finalist for a reason. He's had an unbelievable year, ECAC Defensive Player of the Year, and he's also way over a point a game as well. He's going to be one of the most sought-after free agents in college hockey once his season does end, and he's a phenomenal player centering this line with Harold Zegel and Jack Jacoby.
Yeah, Nico Sturm from Augsburg, Germany. 45 points on the year for him coming into play, and looks to add to that here. And you know, both of these teams in the tournament, there isn't quite that angst about if you don't win, you're not in. But obviously, winning a championship, none of these guys on the ice have done so. With so that also very important.
Yeah, the tradition of both of these programs is very, very strong. You know, going back a lot of years, Clarkson Hockey and Cornell Hockey have won a lot of championships, and there's a lot of alumni watching the game from home. There's a lot of alumni that are here in the classroom right now, and it means a lot to a lot of people to put up a banner inside a Chiel Arena or inside a line of rink. So this game, again, the ultimate goal is to win a national championship. That's what everybody dreams of, but an ECAC championship when it comes to the program that they fight tooth and nail for, you know, the program that gives them a four-year education, is something that means a lot to the kids and means a lot to the alumni as well.
Does Lina have room for any more banners up there?
They got quite a few. Well, the women's team's putting up a lot of banners,
right,
too. So, just like the Clarkson women team. So, they might have to, shift some things around on both rinks.
Well, the Clarkson women have all the banners. The men are going to have to start pulling up their end of the bargain. As we are underway here in period number two, Green going to pick this one up for the Big Red and shoot it around. He's going to bounce out to center, picked up by Mitch Vanderlyn. Vanderlyn on the move. Runs into a pair of Golden Knights, Morrow and Jacome, and it's pried away from him. Moved out to Sturm, trying to jump on it here. Working on McCray. Little drop pass. Goes and gets it himself. Poked away, but right to Eagle. And McCray recovers again nicely. Working on out to center. Pass doesn't connect to Regish, and Clarkson takes over again.
Yeah, and you saw Jeff Malott in the first period going hobbled out. He is not back on the bench right now. You have Michael Regish taking his place on this line with Bo Starrett and Mitch Vanderlyn. So hoping Jeff Malott's okay from that injury, but doesn't appear to be ready to be going right now.
So it could be a loss there. Of course, teams now allowed to draft 19 skaters this season, a new NCAA rule. So back to the normal 18, I guess, for Cornell right now. Although, without Malott. Now here comes Dunn for Clarkson. Pulls up at the wall. Looks for a feed. Alexa just dump it in. That one hit the referee, and it'll be chipped down out the other way. This could be icing here on Cornell. Looks like it will, and it is. 18:38 on the clock, second period. 2-1, the Clarkson advantage.
Yeah, you've seen the referees getting involved a little bit. Again, this is probably the third or fourth time that puck's going around the walls have hit the referee. I think a lot of that has to do with the Olympic-sized rink. And a lot of both teams are trying to rim pucks around in the defensive zone to try and counteract the aggressive forechecks from their opposition. So again, a couple hit refs when it comes to getting pucks around the zone.
Yeah, trying to use the entire width of the rink if you can. This will come down off the dasher for Josh Dunn. Trying to twist and turn and move it to the side of the net. Threw it off the side of the cage in the end, but picked up by Mullen. Shoved into the boards there by Clack, the Georgetown, Ontario native. And now they scrap away in the corner. It'll be played behind by Bald for Smith. Smith to Nuttall. has a man breaking his ball, finds Betts instead. Knocked off his stick. And a big hit thrown at center ice by Mullen, but it's the Golden Knights on the move. Yoki Haryo shot by Callen. That's blocked away. And now Callen will jump on it again. He scored yesterday against Harvard. As they were able to jump out to an early 2-0 lead, Clarkson was, against the Crimson, eventually winning 5-2. Yoki Haryo. Bumped by Smith. Stays strong on the puck. He'll eventually work it back to the point on the indirect. Wrist shot through traffic, goes wide. Mullen lifts it off the glass, but not out of the zone. Kept in by Quince. Callen down low, has some room to work. Wraparound try, threw it through the top of the crease. And now Cornell picks it up again. Eagle catches a puck and keeps it alive. Into the middle. Eagle again. On his backhand. A lot of pressure here from Clarkson. Broken up pass. This will leave the zone. And finally a chance to breathe for Cornell.
Yeah, Anthony Callen line with Marley Quince and Yoki Haryu. They were...
As that one's thrown in front, trying to catch Cornell on a change. And it was Jacome flying into the zone. Now Hurley a shot that goes wide. As Jacome was trying to get a stick on that one. Sturm again. Big green, Golden Knights are buzzing here. As it's Jacome again. Off for Hurley. Sent over, one-timer saved by Galita. Can't find the rebound, and the shot goes wide from Sturm. And now cleared out by Barron, could be icing. They wave it off, good speed by Donaldson.
Yeah, as I was saying earlier, that line with Anthony Callen had a great game against Harvard yesterday. Great offensive zone shift again, and Hemming Cornell in for two line changes.
Clarkson showing how quickly Trent can transition to offense here as Caldwell's moving along. Into the zone for Motley. As Motley takes a bump, kept in at the point by McCray. He'll ride the dasher all the way around to the corner where it's picked up by Vanderlyn. Now Caldas down low. Andreev matched by McLean. Andreev runs out of room. Nice job to spin away. On his backhand goes down to the side of the net and behind. And Dunn gives it right back to Andreev. He'll throw it into the crease. It's loose. And finally it pops away.
Yeah, good offensive zone shift here by Cornell. Max Andreev, the freshman from Russia, showing why he is so offensively talented, getting pucks to the net off of some real good cutbacks coming off along the wall.
That one goes offside on Clarkson. We'll have a stoppage here. No goals so far here in the period, but both teams providing a little bit of offensive pressure each way. It's kind of what you expect here. Clarkson had the puck in the offensive zone for a minute and a half there, really putting some pressure on.
Yeah, both teams known for being pretty good on the cycle. Again, big, heavy teams like to play with the puck below the goal line, bring pucks to the net. You're certainly seeing that here tonight.
Faceoff win for the Big Red. Moved in by Cairns, who didn't play until the third period last night, but he gets a shift earlier on here in the second. As it'll be played along the wall, going down is Sterrett. And moved out by Quince, 3-on-3 as they hit the line. Marley Quince throws it on goal, sticked away by Galita. Puck stuck behind the net, it'll be played there. By Green up the near side. Hit thrown by Cairns, puck back in on Callen's stick. He'll try to move around Leahy, broken up there. Chipped up the boards, that's Rigish, past everybody. Controlled by Hurley. Early on for Yoki Haryu. Campoli takes a hit from Betts as he dumps it in. Galita will leave it aside for Leahy.
And here you see Clarkson setting up in their forecheck, trying to get Cornell to get up the ice with very, very limited options. You see him trying to get up on the controlled forecheck, and as you can see, turnover for Clarkson.
And now Hurley lifts it in the air out to center ice, glove down neatly, and paid by McCray. Smith shoots it in. Wrapping around behind, Kylie stops it there. Didn't get a lot on that pass, and Hurley just elects to shoot it to the near corner. It's picked up by Locke. Brendan Locke out of the corner. Back to the point for McCray, and he stick handles out of the zone and shoots it in. We're going to whistle this one dead for offside. We will step aside. 13:59 to go in the second. Still 2-1. Clarkson on top. 13:59 to play in the second period. Clarkson with a couple of power play goals from Devin Brasso. And them bouncing back from a 1-0 deficit early. It's wrapped around. Noah Bald scoring the lone goal for Cornell so far. Sterrett trying to glove it. It'll be poked at by Eagle, but turned back the other way. Open ice hit there by Jacome. And now Sterrett tried to center. That's intercepted again. And Jacome over to get it. Caledon, Ontario. Jack Jacome, a sophomore, gets it deep as Sturm throws a hit. Sterrett's going to come away. He's got some room and a man ahead of him, Donaldson, and finds him. Donaldson trying to walk in. He's roughed up by Morrow. And now Morrow to center. Eagle takes a hit. It's spun around by McCray. And now Alec McCray has it for the Big Red. Senior out of El Cajon, California. Ahead for Barron. And Barron will fire one in. Saved by Kylie. Hasn't had a whole lot to do since that Cornell goal, really. It's moved on further. That one nearly connected. Now needing a touch up is Clack. He did not. As going for it there was Brasso, but still an offside position. Will draw a whistle.
Yeah, and you got Cornell's top line out there right now, and Josh Howji, who's running the D for the Clarkson Golden Knights. Again, I think those guys are going to see a healthy dose of Aaron Thoe and Greg Morrow, who play a ton of minutes for this Clarkson team. They've been the heart and soul for Clarkson all year. Again, we talked about it last night with the two big guys, and Terrence Amoroso and Kelly Summers graduating last year. They've really picked up the slack, taken up more roles, eaten up more ice, and they've been really, really good for Clarkson all year.
They have guys like Jordan Schneider filling in behind them, the next group that needs to step up into what those guys were doing last year and the year before. Kuzmeski will fire this one around and out to center. Race with puck here. Callen was going to get there first, if not for Galida, who comes out and covers.
Yeah, and you're seeing the Cornell D pinching along that far wall right there. The right defenseman always going to be up, always going to be up trying to pinch. Very, very important that they get back with their back pressure, because Clarkson is a team that's really good in transition. They get that puck past that right defenseman coming through, it's going to be a lot of odd man rushes coming if they don't have guys coming back.
12:31 to go in the second. Still looking for our first goal in the second period. More of what we expected, really a low-scoring game. Those three goals we saw in the first, maybe a bit of a surprise, although the power plays were well executed by Cornell, as well as the two-on-one for the Cornell tally. Kuzmeski has it out from behind his own net. He'll start the Clarkson breakout here. Fed up the middle, Yoki Harjo. Sent across, too hot for Callen to handle, but he tries to jump on it. Kept alive by Kuzmeski. Pounding down behind the goal, Leahy. Chipped up the boards by Barron, all the way down, but no icing here. Kuzmeski will pick it up. Cornell changing all five, and it's moved in by Yoki Harjo. Sturm thought about moving it back to the blue line for Schneider, then gets knocked down by Caldas, and Yanni Caldas will carry. Worked out there as avoiding a hit was Andreev. Looking for a knee maybe that doesn't come. Is moved back behind by Underwood. Campoli chips to center. We got a penalty coming up here. Eagle walking in. He'll go behind the goal. Harold Ziegel looking for options. Finds Schneider. The defenseman will move in. Finally we get a touch of the puck. And Clarkson's going back on the power play.
Yeah, Max Andreev going in to finish his check behind the net. Again, saw his numbers, and when it is from behind, the refs are going to call that pretty much every time. So the freshman, Rush, again, great offensive player for Cornell so far this year, but he's going to be sitting in the box, and this is not something that Cornell wants to see. Clarkson going back on power play, giving them another chance to extend their lead too. And here we see Jordan Schneider coming around, Michael Rigish taking the puck up, and that was just him. I thought that was going to be a replay of the penalty. That was just them touching the puck right there. And here you see Bo Stard, who's been excellent on the draw for Cornell all year, out there first to try and take this draw. Big draw right here for Cornell, and Josh Dunn for Clarkson.
Andreev was the one who was hit moving up ice with a puck. Maybe, it looked like he could have had a knee there, but no call went. And you can see maybe he was upset that he didn't get a penalty the other way and might have gone in a little bit frustrated there. But as is the case, he's in the box. Fourth power play coming up here for Clarkson. They're 2-for-3. Here is Brasso, has those two tallies. Ahead for Callen. Moves it across the line. In for Brasso. Brasso in, a shot and a save by Galida from a tight angle. Nice job by Galida staying tall against that post. Not a lot to shoot at there for Brasso.
Yeah, nice save for Galida there. And Brasso, he's got some moxie to him right now. He's got some jump into his game. A lot of shots on goal. Again, getting that confidence early, but getting those first couple goals, that can do wonder for you as a player coming in. And again, another minute and a half left here on the power play for Clarkson.
As Callen has to step in to take this face-off. Anthony Callen loses it. Betts picks it up, throws it down the middle. A lot of room in the middle. A lot of room to clear pucks. Has to be a bit of an annoyance for defensemen at the blue line. Have a lot of ground to cover. McCray trying to get it out. Get some help from Vanderlyn. Callen back on it here. Fed through, looking for Dunn, but he was tied up. Slam, but not out. Kept in by McCarthy. Dunn with Callen. Wearing that old 44 that was worn by one of those big defensemen for Clarkson last year. And he picked up here and moved out by Kuzmeski. Here's Eagle. We're halfway through the second period. Clarkson still on the power play for their 40 seconds. And he rung all the way out. There's a Eagle's yelling at somebody supposed to be over there.
Unfortunate. Shane Kuzmeski was changing, and Eagle thought that he was going to have a defenseman there to help pick up the puck.
Well, Bald steals it at center ice, shorthanded, moving his way in. Stolen away, however, by Thoe. And gathered up by Vanderlyn. Back for Caldas. And Caldas moves into Jacome, who drops his stick to maybe avoid a potential hook that he thought had been coming. And now Vanderlyn moving in. He gets spilled to the ice. Penalty coming up on Clarkson. And it's going to be a trip, and it's going against Aaron Thoe. And with that, we will step aside. 9:18 to go, second period. We'll play some 4-on-4, and we come back. It's 2-1 Clarkson. Penalty was over, so no 4-on-4. We have a full 2 minutes of power play time here for Cornell. It's first of the game.
Yeah, this has been a special teams game so far. Clarkson getting the first four opportunities. Now Cornell has a chance to get it back.
Cornell on the man advantage this year, 22.5%. They scored 3 goals and 6 tries officially yesterday, although one came very late in the game. Wasn't even a minute long. Still counts on the stat sheet. Vanderlyn across for Barron. Top point getter for these big red is Morgan Barron. He'll fake a slapper, fire it around. Shot comes in, hit Dobson, pops in the air. Schneider has his man wrapped up. Played by Caldas, back for Vanderlyn. For a moment there, he had 4 big red below the goal line. Now they space things out again. Here's Barron once more. Power play tally yesterday, and that one redirects. Could have gone anywhere with just wide of the goal.
What a great redirect there by Tristan Mullen. A good job by Morgan Barron, leading scorer for Cornell. Finding his stick right in the middle. Just goes wide on Jake Kiley.
As it'll be Cornell to break out once more. McCray ahead for a lock. Went away, and McClain just slaps it down the ice. Matthew Galida out to play. Galina out of Aurora, Ontario will help it aside. Andrea, freshman will move it along. Dropped off for McCray. Touch pass along the blue line. Andreev again for Locke. Now they're able to move it in. 41 seconds to go on the power play. Nuttall. Down low, Andreev. Back to Nuttall. Back to Andreev. Nuttall now in the circle. McCray fakes the slap shot. Trying to get around Sturm. Gets it back. Takes the slapper. And that one is, I believe, held onto by Kylie. Somehow.
Yeah, nice little cat and mouse game by between Alec McCray and Nico Sturm right up top by the blue line. McCray, as you can see on the replay, trying to get back to find his shot lane. Nico Sturm trying to get back in there, and a nice shot by Alec McCray. And what a save here by Jake Kylie with Max Andrew right in front of him. Kind of fooled him a little bit, but still got the glove on it and able to cover for a great save.
Yeah, that puck just disappeared. I didn't see Kylie get his glove on it there.
Sometimes they don't ask how, they ask how many, right?
Absolutely, and that's kind of game he had yesterday. Certainly the lone Cornell goal so far cannot be the fault of the netminder Kylie. As this one will pop out of the zone, Barron has it now. Kylie just a junior out of Eden Prairie, Minnesota. He's been stalwart throughout his first 3 years. He's chipped off the boards out of the center. Little kick pass ahead, looking for Sturm. From Foe. And now Morrow. That's why they warm up with the soccer ball, folks. Make a little behind the back kicks like that.
That was a nice little play there by Aaron Throw coming out of the box.
Now it's chopped up the boards to center. McCarthy. Across for Hurley. Cross ice passes a good one to Campoli. Thrown through the middle. And Green had his man tied up. Puck went all the way through. Now Betts will shoot in. We played around to the far side. Moving up ice. Brasso takes a hit, spun around. Gathered up by Betts again. And now a shot fanned on, thrown again, and picked by Campoli. Turned back up ice. Campoli finds Thoe. Stops at the hash mark, throws it on goal. Galina is going to cover this one up. And get a whistle, 6:13 to go in the second. Still 2-1 Clarkson with the lead.
Yeah, you saw Devin Brousseau, the goal scorer for Clarkson, hobbling a little bit, coming back to the bench. Him and Brendan Smith got tangled up a little bit in the middle of the ice. So that's not something you want to see from Clarkson. Hopefully he's okay as we go into the final parts here in the second period.
Yeah, draw coming up in the Cornell end. That, the goal that Betts scored yesterday was a shorthanded goal, an empty netter. It was the first shorthanded goal of the year for Cornell.
Yep, they killed a lot of penalties off, and not a lot of shorthanded goals. Clarkson taking advantage of their power play certainly here tonight.
Clarkson 2-4 on the man advantage. Cornell now 0-1 after their most recent opportunity. But it remains a one-goal game. Rigish ahead looking for Vanderlyn. He had to avoid a hit. And it'll be Thoe who comes away with it. Gonna ring it near side, past Nuttall, no icing they say. Now it's just a race for the puck. Galina. He likes to play it. Quince knocks it down. He's quickly met by Nuttall and Rigish. Vanderlyn chipping on for Locke, broken up by Thoe. This will hop out of play and we will take a break. 5:43 left in the second. Clarkson still up by a goal. You're watching the ECAC Hockey Championship game on ESPN. Thank you. Clarkson still up by one as we're back to action here at Herb Brooks Arena. Jack Jacome takes a big hit there from Green. The puck comes free to Kyle Betts. Tristan Mullen broken up by Underwood. And now Mullen again met by Sturm behind the goal. Jacome, he's wrapped up. Played past Underwood all the way down. Jake Kiley going to come out and play.
Yeah, trying to go low to high there. As you can see, once that puck gets in the corner, you see five Cornell players right in that area. So Ford trying to go low to high, but Underwood was already up by the tops of the circles, trying to hem Cornell in right in that area. So a fortunate bounce there for Cornell to get the puck down the ice.
Cornell putting a bit of pressure on them. They back off and make a change. Caldas now with Clarkson swapping players. McCray will take a look. Alec McCray, fifth in ECAC hockey in block shots. They'll move it ahead to the far side. Had an assist against Brown, although a lot of folks did in that 6-0 win. Here's Smith. Fakes a shot, gets Dunn to go down. Still Smith on the puck. In front, a shot, and that one put just wide. Now Barrett, he'll try his hand. Trying to get around Dunn, walks it to the front of the net. And that was poked off his stick at the last moment. Now Donaldson, a shot that's blocked down by Thoe. Good pressure here from Cornell. Comes away to Dunn, and now here's a chance for Morrow. And it's moved out for Campoli, the lone NHL draft pick on this Clarkson team, a six-round choice in 2017 by the Las Vegas Golden Knights.
What a defensive shift there by freshman Josh Dunn from Clarkson. Again, as you can see on the replay, Brendan Smith coming around. This was the one chance he almost got right there. Brendan Locke getting the puck and just shoots it wide. He might have been looking for Donaldson's stick on the back door. But Josh Dunn, couple great plays there. Brendan Smith coming down, trying to hold it, show some poise. Dunn was right there in his shot lane. And then as the puck came up, nice block shot as well.
Clock winding down in the second period. Face-off win for Cornell. Rigish gets it down low. Pried away by Thoe. Clears to center ice. Turned around by Nuttall. He wants to move it in. Nuttall throws it through the top of the crease. Picked up by Campoli. Has a man to drop it off to Morrow and does. Off for Aaron Thoe. Toronto native will play it ahead but is intercepted by Nuttall. He'll make a drop pass. Sterrett. On for Rigish, just couldn't corral it, and now does off the wall. Rigish, nice move, centering feed, looking for Sterrett. That pass kind of ate him up a bit, also had to deal with Marley Quince, who stole it away and moves it back down the other way. Leahy for Nuttall. Now Bo Sterrett. Look ahead, pass, looking for Mullen, that's broken up. Marley Quince, nice find, Callan. Callan. Trying to give it back, it was Nuttall who ended up putting it wide of the net. Trying to make a defensive play, now a shot goes wide off the stick of Callan.
What an effort there by Anthony Callan to dive and keep that puck inside the zone and create the turnover, and then almost get the scoring chance out of it as well.
Now Callan again battles for it. Continues to do work against Andreev. Callan again. Scored yesterday for these Golden Knights. As a kid, he skated at Bob Suter's rink back in Wisconsin. Of course, Suter on that championship team, that was Olympic gold medal team that played here. As that shot comes in, it's held onto by Galata.
Yeah, being from Chicago, not too far away from Madison, Bob Suter, again, a legend in the area, unfortunately passed away last year. You can see his jersey up in the rafters here right now. Obviously, his son, Ryan Suter, one of the top defensemen in the game. I used to play against him growing up. He's as tough as they come. He's as advertised.
Still playing.
Yeah, still playing. Still playing for sure. But, you know, this is a game right now. You're seeing a lot of really good defensive play. Not a lot going on in between the middle of the ice. Both teams structurally playing really well. And if either team wants to score, they're going to have to start generating stuff through the middle of the ice.
Moved in deep. The Golden Knights on the attack. Wraparound try by the defenseman Schneider. That's turned away by Galita. He was waiting at that post. And now Green. Lifting it in the air, gloved down by Jacome. Did it leave the zone? Yes, it did. Offside whistle goes. 2:21 to go, second period. Clarkson still on top by a 2-1 score.
Yeah, and you're not going to see very much offense on the rush with either of these two teams with the way they play in the neutral zone. Both teams very, very good at holding the red line as you're skating the puck up. Both teams also very, very good at holding the blue line, not allowing guys to come and make plays on the rush. That's why you're seeing a lot of offensive zone play. with these two teams. It's how they generated a lot of their chances, and they're going to have to today based on the amount of defensive play you're seeing in this game.
Shots are 15-12, Clarkson. They hold on to that narrow lead. Underwood going to shoot it in. Skips by everybody, picked up by Schneider. He'll take a shot. Galida has to deal with Jacome at his feet. He's able to make a glove save over his head.
Yeah, I love that save by Matt Galida. Again, not the biggest goaltender in the world, so he's got to play a little bit more technically sound on his angles, and he attacked that puck right away. Puck came along the boards. Cornell not in the shot lane, allowing the defenseman to get the shot. And Matt Galida again at the top of his crease, taking the angle, able to attack that puck and not allow the rebound or second chance opportunity.
Face off here. Sturm up against Betts. One to the corner. As Eagle gets dumped. Pops free. Thoe trying to walk his way in. And now Vanderlyn for Cornell. On the attack. Vanderlyn coast to coast all the way around the net. Snaps a pass off. Save made. Another stop by Kylie. And it's still loose. Across for Smith. To the side of the cage, Vanderlyn, and it's kicked away by Kylie. McCray fans on the shot, and it trickles wide, picked up by Vanderlyn again. Big red buzzing now with a minute and a half to go in the second. There's a wrestling match going on in front of the goal. McCray, little shoulder fake, finds Vanderlyn. Back up top, McCray, a shot, that one flutters over top. And a chance for Clarkson to clear, and they do finally to center.
Well, that play is going to end up on the highlight reel at the end of the year banquet for Jake Kylie. Again, second chance opportunity, something Cornell's going to have to generate a lot of. You're not able to on Kylie because he's so good with his rebound control, but was able to make an unbelievable save off a second chance on that Cornell rush.
McLean throws it at the net. Rosso tried to steer it on goal from a tight angle. Doesn't come off, and now Caldas. Pass Barron, shot back in by Underwood. Caldas again lifts it on out to center, shot back in by Dunn. Right under the tape of McCray. Now Caldas. 42 seconds to go in the period. Some room to work for Donaldson. He'll drop it off for Locke instead. Gives it away. Shot down ice by Brasso. This should be icing, although it goes up on edge. And that helps out the Golden Knights there. They avoid the whistle. Moved on by Locke. 28 to go in the period. Brendan Locke pulls up at the point. Finding Green. And we get a whistle here as the net came off. And we're going to find out how and why in a moment. 21.2 on the clock, and we're going to find out whose fault it was in a moment here.
Yeah, it looks like the faceoff is staying inside. Morgan Barron going hard to the net on a middle lane net drive. Must have got pushed by a Clarkson player into the net, which allows the draw to stay in the offensive zone.
So another big draw. The faceoffs have been relatively even throughout what you'd expect in a big game like this. No significant advantage either way. They're actually 19-15 Clarkson at the moment. A little more of what we saw from the first. I think it was just a two-draw advantage after one. Quintz up against Andreev, the top faceoff man for Clarkson, and it'll officially be a win as it's jumped on by Mullen. 15 in the period. Mullen walking out of the corner. Shot blocked down, still loose. Save made by Kylie. He stood his ground at the post. Five to go. Nuttall behind, trying to center, broken up. Clear to the circle. Andreev will throw to the net, and it's blocked away. And that's how the second period will end, with Dunn on his knees blocking shots. And now we need some players to be separated here as things are starting to flare up here at Herb Brooks Arena, as you think they might. 2-1 Clarkson after one. Two.
Yeah. Yep, not a ton going on. Here you see Tristan Nolan, who had a great shift, starting with the faceoff battle win, getting that puck, trying to bring it to the net. Another rugby scrum right in front of the net. You see a Clarkson player right on top of him. But again, not too much going on in that period. But in the last 3 or 4 minutes, Jake Kylie coming up huge for the Clarkson Golden Knights. He's done that his entire career, that he's been wearing the green, and he's going to have to stand on his head here in the third period to keep this score 2-1.
All right, Topher Scott, we'll have John Lundin here in our second intermission. A little interview action coming up in just a bit. Before that, we will step aside. Your score once again after two periods of play. Clarkson's up 2-1 on Cornell here in the ECAC Hockey Championship game on ESPN.
And we're back with John Lundeen, who is the Director of Communication for ORDA, which is the Olympic Regional Development Authority here in Lake Placid. John, thank you for taking the time to come up here and talk to us during intermission.
Thanks for having me, and thanks. We've got a great game tonight, and well matched up. Looking forward to the third period.
Yeah, definitely. So why don't you start off by telling us a little bit about what ORDA is and what you guys do within the Lake Placid community.
So we were started in 82 after the Olympic Games, and basically we manage, promote, and market all of the Olympic venues here in Lake Placid, including the Olympic Center.
That's great, and obviously the 1980 Olympics was pretty special for anybody that's steeped in American hockey, but we got some great hockey going on here right now. What has this event been for Lake Placid and ORDA in general, with the ECAC coming up here every year playing their championships?
It is ECAC. I think if you walk downtown Main Street, this is the event of the weekend. No matter where you go, if you're a Cornell fan, a Clarkson fan, or last night Harvard or Brown, somewhere along Main Street, somewhere in the community, you're going to see your banner. You know, Lake Placid just really loves this event. We embrace this event, and we're so happy that it comes back year after year.
Yeah, definitely. We have an exciting game here tonight for sure, with two of the top teams. Again, four teams from the ECAC probably going to be in the NCAA tournament. Is that something that helps when it comes to this event in Lake Placid?
You know, I think it does. I think, you know, ECAC has really been growing as a conference. It, you know, the teams are so strong and so balanced. And, you know, for the casual fan, they want to come and perhaps see some good hockey. And tonight's games is an example of how balanced this conference is and how good the hockey is. So, you know, to say that by the end of tonight, that a quarter of the NCAA championship field will be filled by four teams from this conference, and three of the four teams played here in Lake Placid, it goes a long way towards the reputation that Lake Placid has as a hockey town in the area.
Yeah, definitely. You say a hockey town for sure. You're walking down Main Street, you see the ECAC signs and the signs for all the teams around, and we had a nice little snow coming down, so it made the ambiance even better. But, you know, when you talk hockey and you talk Lake Placid, you always have to ask the questions about the 1980 Miracle on Ice game. And, you know, just to be able to sit up here in the same spot that Al Michaels and Ken Dryden were for that unbelievable game, still many years later, what does that game still mean to this town, and how much do you hear about the lore of the 1980 Miracle on Ice?
The lore every day. I'm fortunate enough to work in this arena every day, and I see people, you know, my age with their kids, and they still remember where they were, who they were with, what they were wearing, what they were eating the night that they either heard that the U.S. had beaten the Soviet Union or they saw the game on TV. It was the moment that just, you know, it really brought this country together. And to have Lake Placid, it's 40 years now. It's going to be, you know, 40 years coming up that that game took place and that the U.S. Won, you know, the gold medal. But it is still a big story in Lake Placid, and even with a younger generation, I think in large part because of the movie Miracle, it resonates as much today as it did 40 years ago.
Yeah, definitely. And with the ambiance that we have in the crowd here tonight, I can't imagine how electric it was in 1980. But, John, thank you so much for taking the time to come up and talk to us. This has been a fantastic event, fantastically run on all different accounts. So thank you for coming up, and thank you for your hospitality to the ECAC this weekend.
Great to hear about that. Thank you.
All right, thanks. Back to you.
ECAC Hockey Championship Postgame Party. Tonight, 10 p.m. at Delta Blue.
second intermission here. ECAC Hockey Championship game. Clarkson and Cornell already turning into a classic, but we have 20 more minutes of play, of which to make it even more special. Perilous Garris, Topher Scott here. And Topher, your thoughts through two. It seemed like Cornell was kind of gaining momentum. He had that power play their first of the game, weren't able to capitalize, but had some traffic there. Jake Kiley just standing on his head at that end of the period.
Yeah, that period was a little bit more typical Cornell Clarkson. Very stingy defensively, not a ton of scoring chances. I thought Cornell started to get it going a little bit more in the last 4 or 5 minutes, gaining some momentum. But again, period ended, and couldn't have ended at the right time, at a better time for Clarkson.
So the two power play goals stand as the difference right now. Devin Brasso scoring those two. And, you know, Clarkson hasn't had too many more opportunities after that. It seems like 5-on-5 chances are tough to come by in this game.
Yeah, definitely. Both teams, again, they're very, very stingy defensively. I feel like I'm a broken record saying that all night. But you see, you know, there's not a lot of tic-tac-toe stuff coming through the neutral zone. It's a lot of chipping pucks off the wall. It's a lot of foot races. I thought one thing that Cornell made in terms of an adjustment towards the end of that period, they started flying guys a little bit more, starting to stretch guys through towards the far blue line to bat Clarkson's defensemen up to create some more space in the neutral zone through the middle of the ice. So I think that's one thing that you're going to see Cornell do a little bit more. But again, Clarkson, structurally, they're very, very good. On the back check, they're very, very good. And, you know, Cornell, both teams, only 16 shots on goal. If Cornell wants to get back into this game, they're going to have to start putting some more pucks with some traffic in net in front of Jake Kiley.
Absolutely, and so we'll take one more break. We'll be back with the third period. Your score through two. Once again, Clarkson 2, Cornell 1. We'll be back with the third in just a bit. You're watching the ECAC Hockey Championship game on ESPN. Devin Brasso has the Golden Knights in front right now. Those two power play goals in the first period are the only difference here between these two clubs in this ECAC Hockey Championship game. As we begin the third here, Topher, thoughts as we go into this third period. An important start, you have to imagine, opening moments here.
Yeah, and Cornell typically, one of their strengths is start period strong. If Cornell wants to get into this game, they're going to have to see and hear guys like Barron and Donaldson having the puck a little bit more inside the Clarkson zone. At times like this, you need your big players to step up, and this is certainly the time in the third period of the championship game.
It's just a one-goal game, so you don't have to change your game plan at this point. Until there's, you know, maybe 10, 8, 5 minutes left, then you have to maybe change some things up.
Yeah, I think they've been making some subtle adjustments throughout the game because Clarkson, again, is so good defensively, trying a few different things coming through the neutral zone and things like that. But again, both teams are pretty structurally sound, and you know what? This is going to be an excellent third period up here in Lake Placid.
Here we go, third period action. Sturm throws it into the skates of Caldas. He pops right back to Stair, who dumps it in. Aaron Thoe, left in the corner. Morrow going to wrap it out, but it's kept in at the point by Caldas, and now Vanderlyn. Stolen away here and moved out by Aaron Thoe. It'll be gloved down at center, however. Moved along by Bolt, or Caldas, rather, into the zone. Now turned around here. Jacome had a man breaking. It was done, but couldn't find him. He was looking the other way, but dumped in by Clarkson anyway. Helped around by McRae. Race for the puck. One by Betts, who pokes it all the way down. But Brasso gets there. He'll ring it around. The captain for Clarkson ahead for Clack, who can't clear the zone. Second effort does. Out to neutralize, done. On for Brasso. Brasso trying to make a move. He gets stood up. And Betts comes away with it. As it was actually Bald who ran into Smith like a bowling ball and broke everything up.
Nice job by Devin Brasso and Chris Clack to get that puck outside the zone, especially when you're up by a goal in the third period. Those wall battles and blue line battles are extremely, extremely important.
Jam try in front. Where's the puck? It's behind the goal. Now Mullen back to the point. Nuttall firing. That one's blocked down by Yoki Haryo. Second try. Looking for the redirect that doesn't come. Off the stick of Locke to the point. Here's Leahy. Pulls up, takes a shot. That one skips through the crease. To the half wall, Locke spinning. Backhands it in deep. Schneider takes a look around, throws it off the side of the net, and it's covered up by Kiley. No help, says Jake Kiley, throw it at me from the corner. He bails out his junior defenseman there.
One of the things you love to see if you're a Clarkson fan or if you're a coach standing on the back of the bench is you saw the block shot right there off the Matt Nuttall shot, and we are really, really far up, and we got headphones on, and we can only kind of hear each other, but I heard the Clarkson bench go absolutely crazy for that block shot. It's a great sign for culture, great sign that guys are in it for each other, and that's a great sign for Casey Jones and his coaching staff seeing that with his bench.
Certainly you have to be all together if you're going to make a run, especially in this tournament or the next tournament coming up next week. Talking NCAA, here's Jacome. On for Eagle. He'll take the wide approach here. Jacome cutting to the net, takes a shot. Galida in good position along the post, makes the save. What's he looking to do there, Jacome, with that low shot? Maybe get a rebound?
Yeah, typically when you're shooting the puck from outside the dots, especially on the Olympic side, again, it's very, very hard. You look at the two goalies that we have, but any goalie really in college hockey, you're not going to score from outside the dots very often or up top from the top of the circle. So try and get pucks on net. Try and get guys to the net for traffic, which Nico Sturm and Harold Zegel, they're not allergic to the front of the net. Those guys are in front, and that's where they can bang away home goals all the time. So nice little try there by Jack Jacome, try and get a second chance opportunity for his line mates.
Face off here. Puck sits on the dot for a moment. Now turning and trying to shoot. We got a penalty come up here. It's going to go on Cornell as Jacome was tied up in front of the cage. This is going to leave the zone as Kiley goes off for an extra attacker. Here's Aaron Thoe as Clarkson really slow things down here and set up their 6-on-5 attack. Moved in for Eagle. Thrown to the middle of the ice. It's put away by Green, but no whistle. Now it bounds all the way down the ice, and Golden Knights have to be careful there. There's no netminder in there.
That's a good angle coming back.
Yeah, some heart stopped, I'm sure, if you had a bad look at that puck going back towards your own goal, but slowing things down here, and the elongated extra attacker here with the delayed penalty. Brasso moving his way in on his backhand around behind, thrown in front, and it's going to be covered up by Galida. Looked like an innocent play until no one touched that puck, and it kind of slid innocently through the crease before Galida could pick it up.
Yeah, nice play by Alec McRae. to pick up the stick of the forward right in front of the net for Clarkson. And again, penalty trouble for Cornell. It's been all game. And you got to give credit to Jack Combe right off the draw, faceoff. Again, the puck kind of came back towards Matt Galida, but he beat the defenseman Yanni Collis to a spot. Collis had to take him down. Now Clarkson's on the power play for, I believe, the fifth time tonight.
Yep, they're 2-for-4 as Clarkson. They scored on their first two chances. And, of course, 0-for-2 since. We're just 3 minutes into the third, and Clarkson looking to add a crucial insurance tally here. You don't really call it an insurance goal, I guess, if it just gives you a two-goal lead. It's more important than that. This is the fed all the way down and wraps around. Starrett trying to jump on it. He don't like to just flip it back in. Here's Connor McCarthy. It's a hook, is the call on Caldas. Kuzmeski going to move it in. Around to the corner it goes. Well, took his eye off the puck. Did Callant. It allows Cornell to clear. Brasso slowly back picking up. Clarkson in no hurry here. Being very deliberate out of their own end right now. Almost to a fault as McCarthy has to go back and get it now. Go back behind the goal. A little bit timid here from Clarkson, not something you'd expect, but when you're on the power play, you have to be even more aggressive, you think.
Yeah, no, this is, again, this is a little lackadaisical here by Clarkson. Again, pass is not really on the tape like you saw right there, a little casual coming out of their own zone. So this is a time where they can really step on Cornell and try to get a two-goal lead. It hasn't been going that well for them so far in this power play.
Looks like the Monstars had taking their spirits here for a second. Jacot, I'm going to drop this one back now sometime. A drive, and it's blocked down up into the netting, excuse me, by Nuttall. Big time block there. A guy who's used to getting in front of pucks. He's blocked 57 coming into play tonight.
Yeah, and that's why he was voted the best defensive defenseman in the ECAC. Again, sacrificing his body, Matt Nuttall. Again, when he was recruited to Cornell, one of his weaknesses was his defensive play. So credit to Matt Nuttall and the coaching staff. And here you see a big windup from Aaron Thoe. Matt Nuttall getting right in front of it. And just like what we were talking about with Clarkson, how their bench was after the block shot for their team, you heard Cornell getting right up and loud and rowdy for Matt Nuttall on that play as well. So got to love to see that if you're a Cornell fan or a Cornell coach.
Seeing it both ways now. 32 to go on the power play for Clarkson. Here's Eagle looking for a shooting lane. He'll drop it back into the skates. Amoro has to slow things up. And now Sturm. Off for Thoe. Thoe down low. All the way back to Sturm. Fakes the shot. Now Thoe again. Up top Sturm. A drive. Pad save Galida. And that puck just didn't sit for Eagle. He might have had a lane there with Galida out of position on the save. Now another shot goes wide. 5 to go on the power play. As Cal is about to come out of the box. Here's Morrow. Now he is out. Back to 5-on-5 hockey with 15 minutes to go in the third. Jacome. Hand off there, Eagle. Little shimmy, worked his way around, turning and throwing one off a skate. Hit green, or Brendan Smith rather, as it's poked to the wall. Hit thrown there on Betts. Caldas has it, lifting it along, but he gave it away. Sturm, Morrow, across, back to Sturm, and he feeds it on through. I think he was looking for someone trailing there, and Quince a little bit further behind than maybe he thought. Now Marley Quince, he's watched by Caldas. Quince twisting and turning. Has a man in the slot. Callan calling for it. Elects to go to the point. Underwood down low. Back around for Callan. A drive. Quince blocked away. That time it was green. And Schneider shoots it in. Wrapping around Yoki Hario. More pressure from Clarkson after the penalty expired. Finally Cornell trying to clear. Can't do so. Kept in Underwood. And out of the corner it's Quince. McCray pokes it away from Yoki Hario. And they wrap up there. It'll be lifted high in the air and out to center.
Yeah, that was a great shift for Clarkson right there. And they're going to call the icing. Again, you had a lot of tired players out there for Cornell for a long period of time. A couple guys that had killed almost the 2 minutes of the entire power play. And when it comes to Brendan Smith and Alec McCray, you had Yanni Caldas coming out from the box, having to play forward coming out there. But again, a lot of great pressure by Clarkson. A couple big saves there by Matt Galida on the penalty kill as well.
Every one of those necessary now for Galida, whose team still trails by a single goal. And we may get a timeout here for Cornell. They're waiting to drop this puck.
A little bit of gamesmanship there by the Cornell coaching staff.
I still think they're going to call it. Let's see. go. All right. I could have sworn they would. They still have it, but you know, maybe saving it for a potential review that might come into play. Of course, the challenge that's now in effect in college hockey. Need your timeout for that to make sure of a play you want to see again for the referees. So they don't use the timeout there, and it doesn't hurt them as they're able to clear the zone. Green in his own end goes D to D for Nuttall. Matthew Nuttall to the near side where it's picked away by Clack. He'll backhand into the zone for Brasso. Another drop pass done. Sean comes in, fires along the ice wide, and it's played around to the far side for Donaldson. He'll break out. Could be a three on two if Barron can join the play. Broken up nicely, however, by Morrow. And now they head back the other way. Fed across. We get a whistle here, and I believe an offside will stop play. With that, we will step aside. 12:57 to play. Third period. It's 2-1 Clarkson. We're 7 minutes into the third period. Shots are 3-2 Clarkson in the frame. And Matthew Galida must have some kind of equipment issue. He's over by the bench. Or maybe not. He heads back. Maybe they were fixing it during the break.
Yep, Sean Schmidt. Great equipment manager for Cornell. Getting the job done. Making sure Matt Galida is ready to go. And here we go for an exciting 13 minutes in the championship game for the ECAC.
Though shoots it in. Vanderlyn gets run over there by Eagle, and now Cornell going to break out. Rigish going to pick up his scoring touch here in this championship game. Wraparound try, who was blocked away. Might have hit Chacome in the end. Picked up by Vanderlyn. Vanderlyn drops it off. Rich shot coming. And then by Green, it was broken up. Now he's wrapped up by Sturm. Sterrett in the corner. Vanderlyn flips it back to Green, had some pressure coming, played it ahead. Now it's stolen away by Sturm, who lifts it back down the ice. Rolling puck could be icing, and it's not. They wave it off late. Green picks it up, has a man breaking far side. He'll elect to take the safe out, cross the red line and ring it in.
Yeah, and there you're seeing why Nico Sturm, one of the best two-way players in college hockey right now. See Cornell going all over the place up top by the blue line, trying to change shot lanes and trying to confuse the forwards up top, but great job by Nico Sturm getting the shot lane.
Now Quinns throws it through. Underwood a drive and a right pad saved by Galida. Kicked it all the way out of the zone. Schneider back to pick it up. And he lost it. Pops out of play to the benefit of Clarkson because Cornell had a good bit of forecheck going on there.
Yeah, the Cornell bench not too happy with that non-icing call as it was very, very, very close to an icing. But here we go again. Face-offs, huge part of this third period right here. Cornell probably going to try and set up a face-off play, try attack right away. See Clarkson try and get the puck out inside the zone as fast as they can.
Shots Clarkson leading 19-18 overall. Face-off here.
A little bit of an interesting alignment where you get Cam Donaldson, the right winger, up top on the right point. Brendan Smith down on the far side hash mark. See what Cornell does here.
Faceoff one back anyway for the Golden Knights as Schneider shoots it to center. This is going to be icing. And some Bronx cheer from the Cornell fans who thought they should have had an icing call earlier. It's a championship game. Every detail is magnified.
Yeah, and the Clarkson bench actually not happy with that icing call either. They thought it was tip coming down, but sometimes the refs can't win, you know?
Someone's going to be unhappy with you.
Yeah.
No ties here. Of course, we'll play until we find a winner. Usually we have at least one overtime up here in Lake Placid, and we haven't had one yet. So odds are this one's going, but Clarkson fans don't want to hear that. They're up by a goal, 11 and a half to play.
They do not want to hear that, not at all. So you might be getting some hate on social media from the Clarkson fans after that comment.
That's okay. They know it's just good fun. Here's Nuttall. Turns back towards his own end. He'll send it across for Smith. Poked away, and Smith will pick it up once more. Sent around behind. It'll be Nuttall skated up ice. Matt Nuttall across the red line, dump it in. Foe. Puck bouncing on Morrow. And finally, played by Callan. As it's now out of the corner. Shot around by Campoli. Clarkson hemmed in for a moment, but now they break away. Callan. Shot coming. Zipped it wide off the glass. Now Morrow takes the hit in the corner. Puck pokes free. Donaldson has it now. Cam Donaldson, sophomore from Pittsburgh, North Carolina, moves it ahead for Betts. Betts driving the net. He fired it wide. As he picked up speed as he entered the offensive zone. Now Motley trying to provide an offensive presence with some physical play. Backhand shot blocked down. Loose in the slot. Backhanded away by Quince and gloved down by Campoli. He'll wait as Clarkson's trying to get a change going. Morrow will back things off.
Great effort there by Kyle Betts, not only on the rush trying to take pucks to the net, but on the cycle trying to get it and get the puck to the net on the cycle as well.
McCarthy a drive that Goulet didn't see, but he hammered it a few feet wide. Behind the goal, Kuzmeski. Wrapped up by Vanderlyn. Gets some help from Jacome as they continue to scrap away in the corner. Now Jacome drops it back. Eagle a shot. Redirected by Sturm just wide. Vanderlyn now. Lee's trying to get it out to center and chips it into Clarkson territory.
Nice play there by Jack Jacome to get up to Harold's Eagle. And then you saw again, we have said his name a lot, but Nico Sturm standing right in front of Matthew Goulet trying to provide a screen. And I don't think he saw it. Good thing it went wide.
Out to center it goes. Here's Locke. Wrapped up by Dunn. Bouncing puck gathered at center by John Carter McLean. Back for Schneider. Tipped in deep by Barrasso. Hits off the back of the net. Green's going to play. Spun ahead by Ball. Checks for a two-on-one. Here's Sterrett. Locke with him. Third man in. Shot coming. He put it wide. Brendan Smith with a glorious opportunity. But he missed the cage.
Two seniors in their last ECAC game, and Bo Sterrett and Brendan Smith coming up on the 3-on-2. Brendan Smith, a great pass from Bo Sterrett, and just puts it wide on Jake Kiley.
As I believe we have to drop another puck here. 8:51 to play in this third period. No change on the puck shot out of play. So this group will have to stay on the Golden Knights.
Yeah, and Clarkson got away with one there. Again, great play by Noah Bald on the wall to get the puck up, to get going on the rush. And again, if you're Clarkson, you got to have a third man high right now.
Shot deflected high off the glass. Pinching in is Caldas. Takes a shot from Brasso. Donaldson trying to pick it out of some skates there. Now there's four Golden Knights in the corner. And Barron digs it away. Caldas looking for a lane. Fires. Save made. Loose in the top of the crease. And it'll be cleared out by Brasso. Another opportunity there for Cornell. They're coming in bunches.
Again, you're seeing why Jake Kiley, one of the top goalies in the country right now.
And we have a pass from the defensive zone that Barron was offside on. I believe we will take a look at that play again.
Yeah, there you see, just got it with his blocker. I think it might have deflected off the Clarkson forward. And then again, huge rugby scrum right in front of the net, in front of Kiley. And Clarkson able to clear it outside the zone. 8:20 left. This is going to be an exciting 8:20, Perry.
Seems like we keep adding to it. And Graham to take this draw here. Up against Anthony Callan. One cleanly by Callan, back to the point for Morrow. Wrists one that's blocked over the top of the net. Callan in the corner. He looks to cycle here from Marley Quince. He's wrapped up, though, by Nuttall. And now Quince once more. Looking for Yokihario. Bouncing puck, couldn't corral. Nuttall once more. Poked off his stick. Mullen chips it high in the air out to center. Andreev. Stolen away by Callan. Vandalin trying to find it. And it's Andreev who jumps on it for Cornell. Back to the point. Nice catch by McRae on the backhand. Across. Centering. Deflects all the way through and kept in. McRae going to move it down low for Vanderlyn. Clarkson fans getting more and more vocal here. Everybody is. They thought that puck left the zone. Looked fine from here as Smith will battle in front of the Clarkson bench. Mullen takes a hit. Though across. Some room for Morrow to look up ice. Quickly closed down by Sterrett. Spun ahead. Here is Bo Sterrett. All by himself in the offensive zone. He fires it along the ice. And it goes just fine. Kylie might have gotten a piece of it. Back to the point. Here's Caldas. One-timer he puts just wide. McRae again. Stepping it along down low. Here's Motley. Poked off his stick. And Underwood will alleviate some pressure by chipping it off the glass.
What a play by Greg Morrow, the defenseman for Clarkson. Knocking that puck off of Liam Motley's stick to knock away the momentum also of Cornell. Again, they're starting to get a little bit of momentum right now. Greg Morrow, just as him and Aaron Thell, his deep partner, have done all year. Great defensive play.
Now Donaldson across. A shot comes in from Green, and Kylie sticks it away. Barron in front, looking for a lock, and the shot comes in. That one's knocked down. Scramble in front. It's put out to center.
Just listen to this crowd right now, Perry. This is about as exciting as it can get. Another nice save by Jake Kiley. I have a feeling he's going to have to make a few more in the rest of this game.
Picked up there by Locke. Locke on the backhand. He put it wide. Nuttall working it down low. Goes off the back of the net. Donaldson jumps on it here. Drops it back for Locke. Off the mark and all the way down. Goliath thought about the pass. Now he'll make it all the way to the blue line for Donaldson. Has a man cutting to the net, it's Betts. But he's slowed up there by McCarthy. Shot off the side of the cage. Behind the goal, that's Smith, the defenseman. All hands on deck here. As it's poked to the corner by Kylie. Vanderlyn, under six to go in the third. Looking for the wrap try, no. Vanderlyn, circle for Nuttall. Thrown towards the net, he scores! It's Mullen on the redirection, and we're tied at two!
Tristan Mullen with the biggest goal of his career right now, and what an absolutely smart and unbelievable play by Matt Nuttall to get this puck to Tristan Mullen. Here it comes up at the top of the circle. Tristan Mullen going to the net with his stick on the ice and right through the skates of the Clarkson defender, Yokihario, and a great little tip there by Tristan Mullen to get it over Jake Kiley's glove, who was a little bit screened by his own defenseman right there. And Perry, what a goal for Cornell. Again, another depth player stepping up and couldn't have come at a better time. And this place is absolutely rocking here in Lake Placid.
Sophomore Tristan Mullen out of Cartwright, Manitoba. His second goal in as many nights. And his eighth of the year has tied this game at two.
And one of the things that you're going to see on the replay, if you go back about 25, 30 seconds, is Kyle Betts, one of the fastest players on Cornell. And you talk about it all the time. Get pucks on net, and then you got to get the shot retrievals hard. Kyle Betts with an unbelievable effort to get the puck in the corner. He actually dove off his feet to cause the turnover, which allowed for Cornell to keep the puck inside the zone for the goal.
2-2 game. As Sturm can't clear, puck in the corner. Schneider as Clarkson to try and figure out what to do next as they're going to ice the puck here. We're going to have a whistle. Topher, it seemed a bit like obviously the team that's down is going to have more urgency, but you have to match that if you're the team leading, and Clarkson seemingly was not able to do that.
Yeah, not so far. Again, Cornell putting a little momentum on Clarkson right now as we take another look at that goal, and look at that pass and look at that tip. Just nicks the top of Kylie's shoulder and gets it in the net. Tristan Mullen, Cartwright, Manitoba, to tie the game for Cornell.
If Kylie's jersey was any baggier, he might have kept it out, but it just clipped his shoulder and went in. Dug out of the corner here by Smith. And just walked in front, and Andreev a shot, and that one's kicked away by Kylie. Now Andreev again, walks to the net front, drops it off for Green, a wrist shot over the top of the net. Kept in by Smith once more. It's all Cornell right now with 4:40 to go.
Max Andreev bringing the puck to the front of the net. Probably could have got a shot on goal right there, but elected to go back to the point. That's all right. But I can't imagine what this atmosphere was like in 1980, because this crowd right now, you got a ton of people traveling from Ithaca to get here, a ton of people traveling from Potsdam as well. And icing call, a little bit of gamesmanship here again by Clarkson to try and ease the tension as we go for an icing.
Kylie, the strap on Kylie's mask broke. I could see it from here. So that's getting worked on quickly here by the Clarkson equipment manager, Jamal Barabow. And now Clarkson's going to take their timeout. But I do have the attendance number. 5,713 tonight. Yesterday, a combined two-day total of 10,529 between the three contests. I think yesterday was a two-session ticket. But anyway, huge crowd. This is the biggest crowd I've ever seen here. And, of course, Miracle on Ice, I'm sure this place was packed. But yeah, I completely agree with you. The amount of noise coming out of this crowd right now, it's hard to imagine any louder.
Yeah, and they debate it all the time. You know, is Lake Placid the right place for the ECAC Finals? Again, a big piece of why they wouldn't be here is you play on an NHL sheet all year, and then you come to Lake Placid where it's an Olympic-size ice, a little bit different than what you're used to. But seeing this atmosphere and the type of environment that we have, Lake Placid, a lot of history, a lot of tradition, and you look at the crowd, you look at how into it the fans are. And what we want to do in college is provide these kids an unbelievable collegiate experience with athletics. And you're certainly getting that here tonight. And again, two great teams playing against each other. 2-2 game, 4:34 left in the game. This is going to be an absolutely fun one to end it off.
Clarkson reeling just a bit. About 6 minutes to play. Cornell really ramped things up. Still waiting for the Golden Knights to answer. Puck goes behind the goal. Callen trying to poke it out. As Morrow is wrapped up there with the most recent goal scorer, the game tying goal scorer, Tristan Mullen. And now Thoe to center ice. Shot back in by Betts, but a couple of big red have to touch up. It'll be Morrow. Connects near side to Quinn. Broken up by Locke. Thrown across, but a little ambitious with that pass. It's intercepted and moved up by Callen. Callen into the slot. He gets dumped there by Barrett. Nuttall back the other way. He'll flip it in. Cross corner on the dump. Barron hands it off for Donaldson. He's met by Underwood. And now Locke across. A little touch pass to the wall for Smith. Smith spins it back to the point. McCray, a one-timer way wide off the end wall. Callen's wrapped up by Barron. Steals puck away. Big time move by the New York Rangers draft pick. Now a shot over the top by Locke goes wide. Along the wall, it's Smith again. He's been playing deeper and deeper in the zone as this period has gone along. Now a centering feed all the way through, back out to center ice.
Good shift there by Cornell's top line with Brendan Locke, Cam Donaldson, and Morgan Barron. A lot of line shuffling going on for Cornell right now, with Jeff Mallott not being in the lineup ever since the middle of the first period.
We will step aside with 3:14 to go. We're tied at 2 in the ECAC Hockey Championship game. just 3:15 left in regulation here in a 2-2 game. Cornell and Clarkson for the Whitelaw Cup. And it's going to be McCarthy shooting it past Dunn. This is going to be icing right off the bat on the Golden Knights.
Real good neutral zone defense there from Cornell, not allowing Clarkson come up the near side of the ice. They had to hinge it back to Connor McCarthy. Yanni called this up on his winger, which negated the passing lane and allowed for the icing.
Send it all the way down. Good news for Clarkson as this group was just recently on. We just had a long stoppage, so they should be fine. Dunn to take the draw here against Sterrett. He wins it cleanly. Kuzmeski for the Golden Knights. Junior out of Grays Lake, Illinois, will play it across for McCarthy. Now back to Kuzmeski. Dumping it in. It'll be picked up by Smith, met immediately by Campoli. But Smith gets away, gets some help from Rigish. Now Rigish once more for Cornell. Indirect off the wall for Sterrett. Will fired into the corner. Vanderlyn. Stick met by Morrow. Another tie up there, and now it's moved out by Campoli. He elects to just dump in. Under 2.5 to go. Rigish. Now that they've found that tying goal, that urgency has dissipated a bit for Cornell.
Yeah, a lot of that has to do with Clarkson as well. Clarkson playing really well here in the last 3-4 minutes, regaining some of the Cornell chances.
Moved ahead, nice gather by Jacob. He'll fire it towards the goal. Gonna be looking for a touch from somebody. Doesn't come. Foe in deep. Finds Sturm. Drops it back. Jacob waiting. Drops it for Eagle. Fed towards the net. Hit a skate. Good tie up there in front. It was Mullen who had to deal with Sturm and a potential open net. Yeah. As it's popped on out to center.
Yeah, just as big as that goal was for Tristan Mullen. Tristan Mullen, that tie up in front of the net on one of the top players in the country, equally as big.
Shot comes in from Sturm. It hit a couple bodies who are now tied up in the corner. The puck's going the other way. And a lifting of the leg of Barron put the puck offside. It'll draw a whistle. It was McCray and Jacome who... maybe their equipment was tied up, I'm not sure.
Yeah, and here you see the replay. Nice little drop pass by Jack Jacome to Harold Zegel. And you see Nico Sturm right in his office, right in front of the net. Actually hits off Mullen's skate, then off Galida. And a great tie-up by Tristan Mullen in front of the net and a clear by Noah Ball. But again, if you want to score goals, kids, get to the front of the net. Nico Sturm has done his fair share of it this year, and you see him right in his office again.
Has moved along off the neutralized draw. All of a sudden, we're at a minute 22 to go in the third period of the tie game. Lively bounce off the corner boards, but it's worked out by Cornell. High in the air by Barron, waiting for it, Donaldson, and it's played with a high stick, and that'll draw another whistle. And a stoppage here.
And that's one thing, you see Cornell do it a couple times, because the gaps for Clarkson are so good, specifically on the blue line, holding that offensive blue line. You see Cornell flipping pucks out of the zone, with guys flying a little bit more. You saw Morgan Bear with a nice flip up into the air. Cam Donaldson going, and that was actually very good hand-eye coordination by Donaldson right there. Shows the skill and the talent that he has. Referees thought it was a little bit high, so here we go with the faceoff with a minute 10 right in the neutral zone.
Faceoff one back by Big Red. Green to shoot it in. And Underwood goes down, and it's going to be picked up by Vanderlyn. Now Michael Underwood all over him, but Vanderlyn able to cycle it below the goal line. Under 50 seconds to go in regulation. Cornell, where they've spent a lot of this third period here on the attack. Andreev will stop and go, finds Green. Now Kaldas, he's trying to make a move on Clack. Kaldas all the way to the net, poked away by the goaltender, Kylie. Now Andreev. Look at feed Mullen at the side of the King, who's posted up there. He tries to center. Well defended by Clarkson, and they clear it out to center ice. Back comes Vanderlyn on for Kaldas. 14 to go. Shot comes in, goes wide. Picked up by Bald. He'll go around behind the cage. Pick it up in the corner with 7. Bald, centering pass, broken up by Thoe. Now Bald once more, stolen away by Kaldas, and that'll do it for regulation. Cornell picking up that very necessary tying goal in the final 6 minutes there to tie things at two, and we do have our first overtime of the ECAC Hockey Championships here.
I think my blood pressure is increasing by the second here, Perry. Very well played period by both teams. Cornell probably had the better of the chances. Not a ton of shots on goal, but Cornell got the one where it counted, and here we go. What else can you ask for? Overtime in one of the most historic arenas for one of the best leagues in the country.
The goal by Tristan Mullen is eighth of the year from Matt Nuttall, and Mitch Vanderlyn has this game tied. It came at 14-19 to the third, and that'll send us to overtime here in Lake Placid. We'll step aside and be back for the ECAC Hockey Championship game on ESPN.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes
everybody. Overtime here at Hertburg's Arena. Fairless Garris, Topher Scott. Topher, exciting period. We thought we might see some action there. We got a goal. That's what Cornell fans are looking for, I'm sure.
Absolutely. Cornell fans are stoked here in Lake Placid and watching at home. Great play by Matt Nuttall to get the puck to the net. Tristan Mullen putting his stick down, just gets it over Jake Kiley, who's been fantastic for Clarkson all game.
How much do players and teams practice that kind of thing, the redirect? You see guys after practice, I think, more, you know, some extra ice or before practice, taking some tips and some guys shooting from the point and stuff like that.
I think you're seeing more and more. I think with the way that defenses are playing right now, they're kind of collapsing down low, so you see a lot of low to high going on. We've seen it quite a bit here tonight, and just a great play. Mitch Vanderlyn passed out to Matt Nuttall, and again, I don't know if it's something they practice all the time, but you see it a little bit more in strategy where you're getting a guy in that mid-tip presenting his stick for a tip.
Hey, not a lot of shots in this one. Both teams around the 20-shot mark through three periods. What do you think that is attributed to?
I think it's an attribute to how much these teams are bought into playing defensive hockey. You know, Mike Schaefer is kind of known for that. Casey Jones, who coached with Mike Schaefer along with Brent Brecky at Clarkson, you know, they are really structurally sound. And, you know, they're both really good at getting their teams to buy into playing that way. And to win championship, you have to play good defensive hockey. And we're seeing a great display of that here tonight in Lake Placid.
Lake Placid, a magical place for obvious reasons. And we're going to have another a photo finish, if you will, here in overtime. Someone's going to have to decide this thing. We don't know when. but it'll come on this ice, this historic ice that we've seen happen all those years ago. So that's got to be a cool thing as well.
Yeah, definitely. And this is going to be a memory that these kids are going to have for a long time. You know, I remember playing in these types of games, and you know, you talk about winning championships and things like that, putting a banner up in the arena. There's nothing better than that. It forms a bond that lasts a lifetime. So one of these teams is going to go home just absolutely jacked. One of these teams going home to jack again. Clarkson last year lost this game in overtime. So you know that's in the back of their minds. They're not going to want to let that happen again.
Yeah, I was saying, you just took the words out of my mouth. Back-to-back years, we're going to have an overtime finish in the championship game. Second time I've been able to be up here and call these games, so I'm not going to take any credit for that by any means, but certainly exciting. We'll be back with more from Herbert Green in just a bit. We're headed to overtime in the ECAC Hockey Championship on ESPN. Through 60 minutes here at 1980 rink in Herb Brooks Arena. Clarkson and Cornell all square at two goals apiece. Noah Bald and Tristan Mullen, the goal scorers for the Big Red. Both even strength tallies. Devin Brasso, two power play goals for Clarkson. And that's the scoring in this one so far. Shots are 25-21. Cornell. Jake Kiley, of course, gives him 23 stops. And then 19 at the other end for Matthew Galita. That's very quick math by myself, the RPI grad. Topher, what are we going to expect in this in overtime? I know they always say you're going to either get a really quick goal or it's going to take three periods of overtime to figure it out.
Well, for the sake of my heartbeat and heart rate, I hope it comes quick. You know, I think you're going to see more exciting play. These are two teams that want this badly. Again, Cornell, they haven't won a championship since 2010, and Clarkson hasn't won one since 2007. So obviously a lot riding on this. Both teams losing in the championship game in the past 2 years. Clarkson last year, Cornell 2 years ago. A lot of pride, a lot of tradition. You're going to see these teams come out. I know they're going to be tired, but they're going to be coming out hard here to start this overtime.
And, you know, it seems like it's going to be one of those tight plays. You know, it always seems to be a scrappy goal that kind of wins. You're not going to win a lot of games on pretty goals. That's kind of like the storybook finish, the Mighty Ducks finish. But it's going to be, you know, a fight in front of the goal, a scramble. It's going to finally be able to stick one home.
Yeah, and that's attributed to how these teams play defensively as well. It's very hard to score pretty goals on these teams because they are so sound in their own end, coming back through the neutral zone as well. So I can see this goal definitely being a throw in the puck to the net, off the seat of the pants, off the skate type of thing to win this one here in Lake Placid. And, you know, either way, both teams have had great seasons. Both teams have had a great effort here tonight. Both coaching staffs, all the fan bases for both teams should be very, very proud of these kids.
Well, you're absolutely right about that. And you know, making it this far, you got to credit the two teams that aren't playing tonight, Harvard and Brown, for making it to this weekend. They played admirably in their two contests. It was tough to see them go. We'll see Harvard again in the NCAA tournament. And these two clubs in Quinnipiac moving on, of course. But the White Law still to be decided here. We'll have that decision potentially in our fourth period of play coming up overtime in just a couple minutes. But we're going to take a quick break and be back with that. We're in OT in the ECAC Hockey Championship game on ESPN. About to hit overtime here in the ECAC Hockey Championship. Clarkson and Cornell. Darius Garris here with Topher Scott. And looking back on last year's championship, Princeton won it 2-1 in OT. Took just 2 minutes and 37 seconds for Max Becker to score the OT winner. And of course, in that game, Princeton led for almost the entire game 1-0 until 6.4 seconds left in regulation. Josh Dickinson tied the game for Clarkson. Terrence Amorosa and Sheldon Rempel, none of those guys are playing tonight for Clarkson. But they're the ones who had the lead this time around, and it was Cornell who really ramped things up at the end of that third period to score with about 6 minutes left to tie it up here. Tristan Mullen getting the beautiful redirection on that shot to knock things at two.
Yeah, and as I sit here as a Cornell alum, kind of thinking back on the history, you know, you have a lot of Cornell alums that are watching this game right now, and Cornell's won a few championships in overtime. A few that come to mind, Sam Paolini in 2003 scored a goal against Harvard, great goal. You got Chris Grenier scores in 1986, which was Coach Schaefer's senior year, great year that year. The assist from Hall of Fame legend Joe Neuendijk, Dwayne Mazur, who's still involved in hockey in DEL over in Germany. So those are the kinds of names that you hear in the Cornell lore all the time. All the time hearing those names and how they scored the overtime winners to propel a team to an ECAC championship. And so whoever scores this goal here tonight, whether it's Cornell or whether it's Clarkson, you're going to see that name be remembered forever.
Certainly history will be written here tonight. I know it sounds a little cliche, but you're absolutely right with the way that overtime goals are remembered. You know, even more so with these storied programs that have so much history, it seems like it gets written a little bit harder with that pencil or pen and almost dented into history.
Yeah, and that's why the ECAC is so great too. You know, you got a ton of storied programs, Cornell and Clarkson being two of them, and the ECAC, a winning conference, ECAC also a great academic conference, and you know, these student athletes, this experience that they're having right now is second to none. So congrats to these kids for getting here, and it should be an exciting finish here in Lake Placid.
Clarkson in overtime this year, one win, one loss, two ties. They beat Vermont, lost to Harvard. For Cornell, they are 0-2-4 in overtime this season, losses to Colgate and RPI. As we are underway in our overtime session here. Thoe to center, moved on by Sturm, trying to walk right in, and he hit the post! Oh my! Morrow back to his own zone. It'll be corralled there by Thoe. Eagle pops out to center and back in, says Dan Taggart, we have an offside. The roof almost blew off this place just seconds into OT.
Yeah, and if you're a fan that went to go get some hot dogs or popcorn in between that intermission and didn't get back to your seat, you almost missed the OT winner. Nico Sturm off a nice little feed into the middle, gets a step on the Cornell defenseman and just nicks the post. Nico Sturm, again, we've heard his name all night tonight. What a player he is and what a great person he's been for Clarkson.
Ball stolen away by Brasso. Picked up by Smith. He'll backtrack a bit for McCray. Cross the red line, ring it in. Waiting for it, Clack. Never gets to him. As Underwood going to drop it down and work back behind the goal. Schneider. Oh, hit wet spot in the ice and will spin it out to center. Here's Dunn now. Trying to be the hero. His shot's up into the netting. And that'll get a stoppage of play.
Josh Dunn, another player that we've heard his name a lot here for Clarkson, both on the offensive and the defensive side of the puck. And you know, that's one thing that they've done really well, Casey Jones and his staff, developing two-way players. Two-way players, guys like Nico Sturm, guys like Josh Dunn, guys like Devin Brusso, that can play both ways. And again, you see a lot of Clarkson players that go on to play in the professional ranks. A lot of that reason why is because they're able to play on both sides. So credit to Casey Jones and all the Clarkson coaches before him.
Face off in the Cornell end. A couple of guys you want to watch for here. Get to those in a second. Michael Riegisch for Cornell. And the aforementioned Josh Dunn for Clarkson. They're both second in the country in last lead goals. I like that number a little bit more than game-winning goals, but it's the goal that gave your team the lead in wins for the final time. As the shot goes wide, they both have six of them. And so it's a high percentage of game winners, if you will. Now a puck flipped off the back of the net. Quince. And it'll be lobbed high in the air. And gloved down there by Morrow. And now Thoe will flip it back. And it bounded next to the net. And it'll be slowed down by Morrow. Down the middle. Callan with Quince towing the line. It's flipped in. Picked up there by Green. Or Caldas, rather. Caldas into the attacking zone. Mullen, a wrist shot. That one's blocked in the air. And helped along for Eagle. Eagle will lob it high in the air. It'll come down in Cornell territory. And Dreyev picks it up there. Indirect off the wall. Nearly picked there by Eagle. Eventually turned up ice by Schneider. Right back to him. Underwood. Good connection to Jacome. Jack Jacome navigating neutral ice. Sturm picks it up. He tries to walk his way in. Backhand shot saved by Goliath. pretty calm and collected there was Galida with Sturm flying in. It was on his backhand. Will now be gathered up by Regish. On for Caldas. He'll just lob it in. And they'll chase. Schneider with some pressure from Sterrett. Forces the turnover there. They start to dig back to the point. Spinning it in deep is Smith. Vanderlyn behind the goal. Looking for a passing lane. Vanderlyn still on it. Fanned on the pass but gets it back. Nuttall throws it in. It's redirected wide. Sterrett got his stick on it. Smith now. Nice find. Sterrett. Man cutting to the net. It's balled. Balled in! And a save by Kylie. Where's the puck? And we didn't have a whistle. It's in the goal. But surely they have to have blown it dead. And some confusion on the ice. There's a Cornell player who's lost his bucket. And we're going to have to sort this thing out.
Yeah, definitely. You saw a great pass by Bo Start coming up on his backhand side. Little sauce of Noah Ball cutting down the middle of the ice. And what a great save by Jake Kiley with his left toe. But then the ref who was sitting right there wasn't blowing the whistle. And you saw Matt Nuttall coming down from the point. So here you see Bo Start, little backhand sauce. Right to Noah Bald, and you got Robert St. Lawrence, referee, standing right there, not blowing the whistle, and Matt Nuttall coming down and down and down. Up, changed the three play, and there it was. Might even hit the post. Can't really tell from that angle.
It must be sitting next to Kylie.
Yeah, because here you see Matt Nuttall coming down. And again, we saw the puck in the net
there
at some point.
Yeah.
But the whistle might have already blown by that point. So Coach Schaefer's looking for an explanation. Right now they might be going to video review. We'll see what happens.
This would be a tough one to count as a goal, I'll tell you that.
Yeah. Yeah, you see Coach Schaefer making some hand motions down on the bench right in front of us. I don't think this is one that they're going to overturn, but what a nice play by Bo Start and Noah Bald. But equally up the task, Jake Kylie, who's been the rock for this team all season.
Kylie makes the save and probably in good position. We never heard a whistle. It could have been just the volume here in the building.
Yeah, the volume is...
But the players reacted the same way as we did. They kept looking for the puck.
Yep.
Anyway, we're only 3 minutes into overtime, believe it or not. Feels like an eternity. Is it? Hit a shin pad, loose up top. Caldas a drive, he fired over the top. And Dunn's going to try and slap it out of there. Brasso helps it out to center. Back come McRae, and he'll go back behind the goal with it. Alec McRae to start things out here. Worked up the wall, pass lock into Cornell's end. Morrow, they're going to say it could have been played or was touched. Behind the goal, nearly stolen away by Donaldson.
Nice little play by Aaron Thau there to pick Donaldson's stick up to get that puck out of the zone. That's a veteran senior leadership play right there.
John Carter McLean got it as far as the Cornell zone, but it's turned back the other way. While Bald can't gather a bouncing puck, it'll be flipped out by McCarthy. Now Green for the Big Red. Backtracking in his own end, finds no ball. Nearly the hero once again for Cornell. Ball all the way in, and that deflects up into the net, and he kind of pulled that back. Cornell, or Clarkson stick got in the way.
Yeah, Noah Ball, Mr. Clutch for Cornell here in the playoffs. He's got to be excited to be back up in Lake Placid. He actually went to Northwood School for midget hockey when he was in high school, obviously. And there you see this a lot from Clarkson. Not a lot of pucks getting to Jake Kylie because their defenseman sticks are on the ice so much. So again, that's something that they, if you're a kid that's out there and you're a defender, good gaps, stick on the ice, deflect pucks into the netting. Great job by their Clarkson D.
Draw here in the Golden Knights end, pushed ahead by Motley into the corner. Now Regish turns out of that corner. Fed back towards the point, but broken up. Nuttall tried to dump, bouncing puck will be gathered up again, this time by Underwood. Across for Schneider, ahead for Callen. Callen trying to walk his way into the zone, but he's met all the way by Leahy. Now back the other way, it could be a two-on-one. Andreev in, waiting, third man in is Regish, and the shot is blocked away. We have a penalty coming up, and it's going to be interference on Quince. as he was trying to deny that odd man rush and ended up running into one of the big red, I think it was Motley, and taking him out of the play.
Yeah, and here you're going to see on the replay, Marley Quinn getting up, just getting into it, and who knows what would have happened there had the net not come off. What a nice poise play by Max Andrea of the freshman. Another freshman driving the net, and then another freshman, Michael Regush, joining the play on the back end. But here you go, Cornell's second power play of the game. It looks like the refs are doing a little bit of a huddle right here to try and sort some things out. But it looks like Cornell is going to go to their second. Actually, it looks like the refs are going to be going to the video to try and see what type of penalty this is going to be. And I think the only review... Oh, they might be reviewing for a goal if that puck would have went in the net, had the net not come off. I don't believe you can do a review on a two-minute penalty. I think the penalty reviews are only for five-minute majors. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. And they were doing a no-goal. So okay. The refs come out, signal a no-goal, just checking to see if that puck went in the net before the net was off.
Yeah, I think Schneider ended up actually blocking the shot.
Yeah, that's what it looked like.
In the end, into the corner. So it became a moot point, other than the fact that Motley was at the post and Quince made the decision that he needed to get in his way to disallow him to get to that tapping, that backdoor tapping.
Yeah, and again, great play by all three freshmen. Liam Motley driving the net, Max Andrea pulling up, Michael Regush, and here we go. This is gut check time for both teams right now.
Cornell to the power play. As that pucks out to center, shorthanded comes Schneider into the slot. His shot blocked away.
Jordy Schneider, the son of Matthew Schneider, NHL legend, played for a lot of different teams, very good offensive defenseman. George Schneider, a little bit different, a little bit more of a defensive defenseman, really, really big, long reach, can really skate, really good on the power play, nice read to get up right off the faceoff.
Cornell so far 0-for-1 on the power play. That came back in the second period. They had one shot on that man advantage. Clarkson, on the other hand, all their offense coming from the power play. They're 2-for-5. As on comes Caldas for Cornell. A little over 5 minutes into OT. Barron lifts it off the end wall. Vanderlyn spins away from John Carter McLean. And now Mullen, the man who sent us here, back to Caldas. Trades places with Barron. Morgan Barron, fan on the pass. Clarkson thought about skating shorthanded, and then it was Sturm trying to make a nifty move around the last corner defender. That didn't come off, and now he'll go off on a change. Vanderlyn into the zone. They're onside, although it appeared could have been tight at the line. Will be played behind the goal. Though, got a touch in front. Loose there. Cleared to the point and out to center ice. Morgan Barron back to pick it up.
Nice little try there by Mitch Vanderlyn and Cam Donaldson getting the puck into the middle of the ice for Tristan Mullen, who's really good in that bumper position, obviously, as we saw from the 5-on-5 goal to tie this game up. But good job by Clarkson to clear puck.
On comes Nuttall. He will skate his way in. On Thoe, left in the corner. Over to help out is Clack. 30 seconds to go on the Cornell power play. You don't see a lot of those in overtime. Right now, Clarkson trying to survive it. 20 to go on it. Across, here's McRae with Locke. He leaves it for him there. McRae once more. Back to McRae, Locke in the corner. 8 to go on the power play. Nuttall turning towards the half wall, watched by Clack. Andreev behind the cage looking to center. That's broken up nicely by Dunn. Out of the box. Still on the attack. The net's off. And Kylie has to make the sprawling save. I think it came off when Kylie went right to left. As Clarkson for the time being has survived that kill.
What a kill it was by Clarkson. I'm not sure if Cornell even got any shots on that power play. Really good job clearing pucks, as we'll see here on the replay, do a really good job of blocking shots, but Alec McRae gets it at the point. He's really good. He has been all year. Nice little tip right there in the bumper position, but as you can see, that net is off already. So that goal wouldn't have counted either way, but if you're on the Clarkson bench right now, you got me absolutely jacked by that overtime penalty kill, because, hey, you don't get many of them, and that was a really good job by them.
Certainly, and Nico Sturm has looked the most dangerous individual player in this overtime so far, nearly breaking free a couple of times, including one short-handed, but not on the ice currently. It's the Quince line up against Betts here. 13:07 to play in overtime. Puck tied up on the dot, goes deep, McCarthy. Gathered up by Callen, he'll fire it to center, nice find, it's Quince. Has Jokiharjo with him, they're onside. Quince snaps his, or excuse me, Jokiharjo snaps his stick in half, and now back comes Cornell, 4-on-3. As Jokiharjo went to the bench for a new twig, Smith has it along the wall. Clarkson recovers defensively. Played in towards Mullen. He's wrapped up there by Kuzmeski. He'll come away with the puck. To center he goes. Picking up speed, has to deal with Jokiharjo's broken stick. And it's moved back out. Now it's Callen. He nearly was stripped, played back ahead. Kuzmeski. Eagle back to Kuzmeski. He'll go behind the goal. Drops it off. Morrow fires a shot. That's blocked down. And Sturm maybe took his eye off it there as he tried to kick it to himself, but it went back out to neutral ice. Give it away at center. Here's Vanderlyn on for Rigish with Caldas. Caldas turning in the corner, lost an edge. Rigish wrapped up by Sturm. Puck comes free. Worked to the near side wall. Barron's there. Overtaken by Sturm. Those two heavyweights duke it out. And that'll be fed to an open wing for Kuzmeski.
Yeah, good job by both teams right here. Again, the stress and tension level, you can feel it in the arena. Every little broken play, every little time there's some space with a guy coming up on the ice, gets a little bit heated. And here we go with Cornell coming up on transition.
Lock with a nice find. Donaldson giving some room, he fires! And that one's blocked away by Underwood. Poked towards the point where it's gathered up. Eagle. Oh, trying to dance through is Brasso. That's denied. Back comes Barron. He'll stop at the blue line, and he pulls it back across the line. Says the linesman on the far side. 11-11. Make a wish here in overtime. 2-2 game.
11-11, 2-2. Again, what a... This has been such an evenly played game, hasn't it, by both teams. Both teams doing a great job through the neutral zone, trying penetrating transition through the neutral zone. And again, you see a great job by the Gavs by Clarkson forcing that offsides as Morgan Barron stopped right before line.
We have a neutral ice faceoff coming here. Betts against Dunn. One back by Clarkson. Here's Underwood. Connects to Barrasso, intercepted by Mullen. Trying to turn things around in a hurry, but he lost it. It'll be gloved down by Mullen, but over skates. Now Dunn walking in. Wrist shot blocked. Oh, it goes just wide. It hit Nuttall and went wide of the cage. Galida seeing it late there. Reminiscent of what we saw last night. The puck didn't go in. Now the Nets come up in the air. Galida trying to put it back on its pegs. We're still playing. Shot comes blocked out to center. And Ball's going to feel that one. And now we get a whistle. What's going on here? Looked like the net was eating Glida alive, and we didn't get a whistle.
I could not believe that the refs didn't blow the whistle right there. Matt Glida was trying his best to get out of the net. It looked like his head was actually stuck up in the top part of the net. As we see Josh Dunn trying to get around Yanni Caldas, and there you see it. You see Matt Glida stuck in the top of the net. And for some reason, the refs weren't blowing the whistle. Again, that would not have been, if that ended up being a goal, a lot of unhappy Cornell fans. But looks like McElhinney is a little shaken up right there in the net right now, but I think he's going to be okay.
Yeah, a lot of straps and buckles that could have just caught into any part of that netting when his head was up in the top of it. I'm shocked they didn't blow it, but I guess the rule says if the net's still on its pegs, you can put it back down again. You got to play on. Still one of the more odd situations you'll ever see.
Yeah, usually you don't see a goalie's helmet stuck in the top of the net, though. So that's, you know, I've seen a lot of things in hockey, been involved for a lot of years. I think that's a first for me.
This is overtime. This is Herb Brooks Arena. Shocking. Yeah, it's certainly... He wasn't doing it on purpose. I'll tell you that much. He's trying to separate with his glove hand. It looks like the top... Yeah, you're right. The top of his helmet was stuck in the net. You may never see that again.
Yeah, I don't think so. And looks like everything got evened out. We're going to have a faceoff hit at center ice. 10:36 left in the first overtime. 26 shots on goal for Cornell in the game, 24 for Clarkson. Again, two evenly matched teams. You knew it was going to be a close one from the puck drop. And if you've paid for admission here, you're getting all that you asked for.
Absolutely. We got a new center ice draw coming. Quince against Andrea. And the puck never left the dot. Now it does. Morrow off for Tho. Ahead. Nice catch by Callen. Into the corner he goes. Back to the point. Shot comes. Actually only to the circle. Quince now turning and shooting. Morrow over the top. And that one's going to stay in the zone. Great keep by Tho, but Cornell takes over and they want to skate.
Yeah, that was a nice save there by McElida on his with his left toe.
Shot in by Green, caroms all the way around. Andreev picks it up there. He'll ring it deep. Morrow with McCray. Thought about pinching. Now it's given away to Donaldson. Donaldson in front. Poked away by Kiley with a stick. And he sent Donaldson reeling. This one's going to leave the zone once more. McCray's going to shoot it back in.
What a poke check by Jake Kiley right there. Cam Donaldson, second leading scorer on Cornell, bringing the puck to the front of the net after a little bit of a whiff play by Greg Morrill. But Kiley, again, showing why he's one of the top goalies in the country.
On for Sturm. Here he comes. Nico Sturm into the circle. Sturm shooting, and that one's blocked away. Kick to the corner now. It'll be gathered up by Smith. Long pass onto the tip of Donaldson. On to Barron. Barron will throw it behind the goal. He had Locke at the far post, but couldn't find him. Now Donaldson walking his way in. Shot and a save by Kiley, and he'll hold on for a whistle.
Wow, all I can say is what an unbelievable defensive play by Michael Underwood right there. And then Cam Donaldson showing why he's one of the top offensive players in the country. Dances around Jordan Schneider trying to go 5-0 and just gets the bottom of Jake Kiley's pad. And we'll see it here again in slow-mo. Takes it to the front of the net. Might be a penalty, not in overtime. But the refs are putting their whistles away. And nice little save by Jake Kiley.
Looked like the five hole opened up for a very slight moment there, and Donaldson looking to go up over the glove. Wasn't able to get past Kiley. Not many are able to.
Yeah, and again, I want to reiterate what an unbelievable defensive play by Michael Underwood. You know, Cam Donaldson was bringing the puck up on a rush, saucers it into the middle to Morgan Barron, who was coming down, and Michael Underwood shifts over ever so slightly, gets down on his stick, and forces the turnover to go into the corner. So great play by a young player, young defenseman, who's played really well here tonight as well.
Shots are 28-25 Cornell here. Faceoffs 36-27 Clarkson. And oh boy, what's this? McGrath is coming in. Austin McGrath, the sophomore from Lloydminster, Alberta. 4-1 when Matthew Goliath was injured. 202 goals against average and a 924 save percentage. Has checked into this game in overtime.
It looks like Matthew Goliath got hurt on that play where the net was stuck on his helmet. Not sure Ed Kelly's tending him to him right now, the athletic trainer for Cornell. But talk about Austin McGrath. When Matt Goliath went down earlier in the year, he was a rock. He was a rock for Cornell coming in. Again, zero games played, and coming in and with those stats and how he played. And again, if you don't have Austin McGrath winning those games, Cornell might not be in the NCAA tournament if they lose this game. So Austin McGrath, big time job for him during the middle of the season. He's going to have to do a big time job here in one of the biggest stages he's ever going to play in.
His last start was January 19th against Dartmouth. He made 22 saves and a 4-1 win. He actually earned all Ivy League goaltender as that shot comes in. Kiley, the shot from Smith. He earned all Ivy League goaltender just from that performance in those games. They happened to come, obviously a good point as far as the Ivy League season is concerned, to earn those honors. That tells a lot for how you played in the relief.
For sure, and it epitomizes Cornell's season. They've had a lot of guys going down with injury, and it's just been a next man up mentality for the Big Red. Certainly epitomized by Austin McGrath coming in the toughest position you can have in hockey.
Yeah, this doesn't get any tougher than this. Now Vanderlyn behind the goal, wrapped up by Tho, stays on the puck. Mitch Vanderlyn twisting and turning. Legs have to be getting more and more tired. Smith on for Mullen. Watched by Morrow. He'll go around behind the goal. It'll be chipped up the wall. McRae takes a hit there from Yoki Hario. He still has his legs enough to throw that hit. Now a chance for the Golden Knights to break to center. Looking to probably get a change. It'll be dumped in by Tho. Now McRae with a little bit of forecheck pressure coming. It's chipped down out to center ice.
And here you go. It's just like the second period, but the long change. So tougher to get changes specifically for defensemen. See Brousseau standing out by the offensive blue line, waiting to kind of maybe see if there's a change and a little bit of an opening. But good job by Cornell on the neutral zone. And whoa, here we go. Door opens and Brendan Smith gets hit.
Oh my.
By Josh Dunn coming through and the door opens. So hopefully he's okay. Looks like he's all right. Getting right back up. Probably a little bit of a laugh knowing Smitty.
Yeah, you got to latch that door tight. That's not supposed to happen. Oh, boy. Well, we needed more bizarre things to happen in this overtime, and we got it there.
And here you see the replay. Josh Dunn.
Glad he's all right.
Yeah, Josh Dunn, a little bit of a hit. Ooh. Door opens. That is a dangerous play for sure.
Smith's head hit that stanchion there, but luckily with not too much force, thankfully.
Yeah. So here we go. Faceoff, Josh Dunn, who's been unbelievable in the faceoff circle so far this game. Against Kyle Beck, one of the best defensive forwards for Cornell. So here we go. Again, little things like this. These are what make games in these types of situations.
8-10 to play here in overtime. Austin McGrath has checked into the game, presumably for an injured Matthew Goleta, but cannot continue, although he did for about a minute or so after he was stuck under the cage. As now Dunn is wrapped up in the corner. Vanderlyn trying to work it down low. Kuzmeski takes a look, throws it between Dunn and Brousseau. This could be icing on Clarkson, and they wave it off late. Brousseau takes a hit. Barron picks up the puck. He'll turn up ice. Could be a 4-on-3 if they hurry. Into the skates of Ball. Ball pulls up, hands it off. Barron shot in the glove, saved by Kiley. And that'll negate any odd man advantage that Cornell had, but we do get a stoppage, 7:29 on the clock. Mike's a little bit tired there. Maybe earlier in this game they tried to rush up ice 4-on-3, but a little bit discombobulated there for Cornell.
Well, this becomes a little bit more of a mental game right now, and I got to say, what a great job by Noah Ball getting that pass in his feet. So for all the kids watching, you get a bad pass in practice, it gets in your feet, that's actually a good thing, because once you get to this level, the saying that goes is you can't give a good player a bad pass because they catch everything. So good job by Noah Bald right there. For all the kids listening, make sure that you're catching passes, not just on your tape, but everywhere else too.
Through neutral ice, Schneider, or through the middle of the zone, I should say there. Finally found the neutral zone. Jacome into the offensive end now. It'll be gathered up by Nuttall. Spinning around for Barron. Chipping. And Donaldson, he'll take a look and find McRae. Bringing it in. And now Underwood back to pick it up as we approach 7 minutes to play in OT. Jacome has Eagle in front of him. Can't find him, but broken up nicely by Mullen again. He's having a great game. Sent behind. Underwood wraps it past everybody. It was touched, I believe, by Caldas. So Green will have to play here. Alex Green, near side Caldas. Just out of the reach of Vanderlyn. This will be icing on Cornell.
Yeah, and that's a tough one right there. Yanni Caldas, again, second team all ECAC, trying to get the puck up to Mitch Vanderlyn. 96 career points now after the assist tonight. Just a little bit of a miscue. Those little miscues, you never know in these types of games. Now you got Anthony Callen, also another guy who's a good faceoff guy for Clarkson. He's going to be taking the draw against freshman Max Andrew for Cornell.
65 on the clock now. Green going to lift it off the boards out to center. And Morrow. Tho ahead. Nice find. It's Quince. Quince in. Takes a shot. First stop of the game is a little bit of a hesitant one for McGrath, but he's able to make it and find Caldas. Caldas into the zone as a man on his right. Rigish. He'll work his way around the goal. Michael Rigish. Nuttall picks it up. Nuttall around, backhands it all the way through. There was no one on the other side other than Tho, who was able to lift it back the other way.
Yeah, and there was no one on the other side because Greg Morrow, one of the top defensive defensemen in the ECAC, picking up the stick of the Cornell forward in front. So again, Greg Morrow, been calling his name a lot tonight for great defensive plays.
Nice find here, it's Clack. backhands it behind the goal. Brasso over to get it. Had two goals in the first period. And that's everything for Clarkson so far. Two power play tallies. Good poke check there. Should have been offside. We play on. Here's Brasso. He'll go behind the cane. All the way around. A backhand shot. They score! Chris Clark wins it.
Should have been offside. I don't know if you can. I don't know. I think you can. I actually think you can review for offsides. And that's what Mitch Vanderlyn is going over to talk to the refs about.
It was a great finish.
Yeah, they're going to review it right now.
But they're going to look at it. They have to. Chris Clack, if it stands. It's his fifth goal of the year. A freshman from Georgetown, Ontario. And former Penticton V off a great feed from the far wall.
Now, I'm not sure if they're reviewing whether it was a kick or whether it's offsides. Again, you have the linesman that are in the box right now looking at it. But you got to hand it to Clarkson either way. I mean, what a play by Devin Brasseau getting the puck and bringing it around the net on his backhand to the front of the net to find Chris Clack right there. And it'll be interesting to see what the refs come up with after this video review.
This would be one of the most bizarre moments in sports if they call it a good goal. Now they can really celebrate. Clarkson, their first title since 2007. The Clarkson Golden Knights have won the ECAC Hockey Championship.
Congrats to Casey Jones, Brent Brecky, and Josh Howgie on an excellent year this year. Again, turning it on late. They went out to Arizona, won the Desert Classic against great teams like Arizona State and University of Minnesota Duluth. Great senior leadership by their leadership group. Again, you lost a lot of big names last year. Sheldon Rempel, Kelly Summers, Terrence Amorosa, Josh Dickinson, and you had younger guys come in and step up right away. Again, you look at Nico Sturm, just unbelievable season. There's a reason he's a Hobey Baker finalist. Jake Kiley also unbelievable in net. And then you look at the top pairing, Aaron Thoe, and you look at Greg Morrow. Those two guys play a ton of minutes, stepped in when those two big defensemen left to play huge roles. And congratulations to the Clarkson Golden Knights winning the 2019 ECAC Hockey Championship.
Been a long time coming for the Clarkson Golden Knights. They were oh so close last year when Princeton was able to beat them in OT. They're going to go through the traditional handshake here as Cornell can only stand and wonder what could have been. Opportunities, of course, for both of these clubs in this game to win it. And anytime a game is decided overtime, it's elation and, you know, supreme disappointment or feeling of hurt, pain for this Cornell club. Ever so close to this one as you get a look at the teams at center ice there. Yeah. So luckily for both of these teams, they're both headed to the NCAA championship. You want to win the White Law, but it's there's still another day to play, and they'll head back to practice on Monday and prepare for their next game.
Yeah, definitely. Again, that's one of the things that's so special about the ECAC, specifically this year, sending four teams to the ECAC championship game, to the NCAA tournament. It's huge for the league. It is huge for the league. Again, you're seeing more and more players go on to play in the NHL and to play big minutes in the NHL. You're seeing a lot of great coaches being rewarded. You know, Casey Jones, he was an assistant coach for a lot of years at Ohio State. He was an assistant coach at Cornell. He actually left to take the
Clarkson job, and I came in to take his place when he left to take the job. And, you know, it's taken him a couple years to really get it going at Clarkson, change the culture and things like that. And this is just years and years. And again, you have to not only congratulate him and the assistant coaches on staff right now, but you got to congratulate guys like Andy Jones, who's at UMass Lowell. Got to congratulate guys like Phil Waugh, who built this team to where it is right now. Because coaching, when you're an assistant coach in college, it's not just what you do on the ice, it's what you do on the recruiting trail. And kudos to all the assistant coaches out there for Clarkson that brought in these guys that allowed them to win the championship here today.
Certainly a similar feeling to a year ago when Kristen was able to win it in overtime. It was a play off the wall towards the net, and a tap in from point blank range. Chris Clack getting the goal. His fifth of the season at 14:36 from Devin Brasso, who had a hand in all three goals here tonight in the championship game. So you have to imagine he's the most outstanding player, the tournament MVP, Brasso. As the Golden Knights have their championship hats, they're going to soon be awarded the trophy. Steve Hagwell, we talked to during our first intermission, is going to present the trophy here momentarily. An incredible game. We had opportunities all over the place, some things you will probably never see again. Unfortunate that Goliath had to go out, but at the same time, Austin McGrath, I don't think anybody gets to that point-blank tap-in. Rosso's accepting that MVP award here. See if we can get it on the screen there. There is Devin Brasso with Steve Hagwell. And here comes Nico Sturm. Brasso and Sturm taking pictures with the cup. And there they go. The sixth ECAC Hockey Championship for Clarkson. Previous titles came in 2007, 1999, 93, 91, and 1966. Playing in their 14th final, I should say, their second in a row. And they certainly get redemption from a year ago to win the 2019 title here. As they're passing around the cup, as is tradition really all around the world in hockey, to give everyone a touch and a chance to hold on to the championship trophy.
And is there a guy, again, the first person to hold up the trophy, Nico Sturm? I don't know if there's a guy more deserving than him to lift it. Again, he's wearing a C as a junior. And you talk to the Clarkson coaching staff, you know, they talk about him as an absolute pro. Somebody who does everything the right way, makes the right choices on and off the ice. Somebody that's just a true born leader. And he's going to make an NHL team very, very happy at some point in the near future.
Certainly the upperclassmen then the ones to get to raise the cup here. But a tremendous atmosphere. We really couldn't ask for too much more. The two teams that ended up bringing their bands to Lake Placid, both playing in final, made it even more special as Jake Kiley gets a huge cheer from these Clarkson fans. And other than Sturm, maybe even more so, this Clarkson team wouldn't be where they were without Jake Kiley.
Yeah, Jake Kiley has been, like we said, he's been a rock for them all year. He's, again, you don't see a goalie wearing a letter on his chest very often, but he's been awarded the assistant captainship, again, even as a junior as well. And you know, one thing that I want to do right now, Perry, is a special shout out to Brent Brecky, assistant coach here for Clarkson. This is his first year. Brex is a guy that I actually played for 4 years at Cornell, and he's the guy that got me into coaching. My first year was a graduate assistantship at Miami of Ohio. He was there at the time. There's not a better person in the entire NCAA. He's an unbelievable guy, unbelievable mentor, and very, very happy that he's able to win a championship here today.
Certainly you have to be happy there. And Like I said, these two teams, they come up here a lot. They make a tradition of coming to Lake Placid. You know, Cornell three times in a row coming up here. And, you know, it seems like it happens all the time. But you look at these two schools, and Cornell's still looking for that first title since 2010. And, you know, Clarkson maybe gets the monkey off its back. They've been a great team for, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 years before that little bit of a drought they had as far as making it to titles and going to NCAA tournaments. But it seemed like this was one thing that was still eluding them, was winning this title. And, you know, they're finally able to do that. And, you know, Clarkson will have to wait, or excuse me, Cornell will have to wait another year. But they certainly have the foundation to come back again, and you have to be excited about what that brings.
Yeah, definitely. And again, they have very good senior leadership. They got a lot of guys, but they do have a lot of guys playing roles that are a little bit younger. And that's got to be something that's very, very positive for the program. That's something that Casey Jones and his staff have to be very, very excited about. Not only winning the championship now, but this team is going to be a force to reckon with in the future, too.
I remember the reason that sticks out in my head is going over to Ireland with this Clarkson club. Might not be personally, I was there with RPI, but seeing them win in Belfast brings back memories of that, and their band actually came out to that as well. These fans for Clarkson will go just about anywhere in the country, or what I found out, in the world, to follow their team around. So that was certainly special to see them win this cup as well. As an RPI grad, I have to kind of put aside that part of me to let Clarkson celebrate this kind of occasion.
Yeah, and what an occasion it is here in Lake Placid. Again, you see a ton of Clarkson fans still right here cheering for every guy that's able to lift the cup up. And Anthony Callen, what a guy. I mean, he had an unbelievable weekend. I thought he was probably Clarkson's best forward, if not his best forward, one of the best forwards yesterday. What a job by him. And here it looks like we got an injured player lifting the cup up with help from Captain Devin Brousseau. And, you know, what a moment for these kids. This is something that they're going to remember forever, for sure.
And who's this? All right. Still passing it around. For some reason, you're just joining us. Clarkson, in overtime, has won the 2019 ECAC Hockey Championship over Cornell here in overtime. And there we go. The final hoist here. I think they want coach in there.
Yeah, Casey Jones lifting it up. He's handing it off to assistant coach Josh Howgie right now.
There he is.
One of the most well-liked guys in the business. And there is Brent Brecky, one of my mentors, lifting the cup up right now as well. Again, great job by this coaching staff coaching this team up. And looks like they're going to be taking a picture in front of their fans.
All right. Well, that's about enough for us here tonight. As Clarkson is Whitelaw Cup champions, ECAC Hockey champions here in 2019. For Topher Scott, I'm Perilous Garris, and all of our RPI TV crew here in Lake Placid. Your final score in overtime was Clarkson 3 and Cornell 2. You've been watching live coverage of the ECAC Hockey Championship on ESPN.